Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
The internet is full of half-truths and all-out lies. We've all seen them, and many people on social media complaining about it. Here's your chance to show and prove. WorldAfropedia.com is a black-owned and operated encyclopedia. There are several thousand articles, but we need help. We can't uncover all the truth ourselves. So please, join us and become a writer, editor, or blogger for WorldAfropedia.com today. Every little bit counts. We owe it to the future generations to put the truth out there. Visit WorldAfropedia.com, the African-centered encyclopedia, a global database of African knowledge for the purpose of bringing about global African wisdom and understanding. WorldAfropedia.com.
They weren't just a damn whistling. Oh, I got my share of coal blacks and horse faces and gummy mouth bitches out there in the field, but the lion's share of my lady niggas is real show ponies.
Back in 2007, at a flea market in Springfield, Tennessee, a woman found a yellow cloth sack. On the sack, hand-stitched in red and green needlepoint, was the story of a woman named Rose and her daughter Ashley. They were both slaves, and when Ashley was 9, she was separated from her mom, Rose, and sold in South Carolina. The sack was a gift from Rose to Ashley, and the stitching included a signature of Ruth Middleton, the granddaughter of Ashley, and the year 1921. That stitching was all anyone knew about Rose and Ashley and Ruth Middleton. But then, Central Washington University's Mark Auslander began investigating.
The first thing I thought about was, well, Rose is a very common name and one of the most common names of all enslaved women in the 1800s. Ashley's one of the very rarest. So that seemed a little bit interesting. Also was interesting, if you look at the wording of the sack, which says that Ashley was sold away from her mother as a 9-year-old girl in South Carolina, that needlework suggests that probably Ruth Middleton, when she was embroidering this sack, did not, in fact, live in South Carolina. Because if you lived in South Carolina, you'd say, well, this happened over in Fairfield County, or this happened in Edgefield, or this happened in Columbia. You wouldn't say in South Carolina.
So that, like, geographic specificity was missing?
So, which suggests that this was probably what we call a great migration story. Starting, of course, around the time of World War I, so many African Americans left the South, came north, Chicago, Detroit, or up the eastern seaboard, and eventually, of course, came out here to Puget Sound. And at that point, certain kinds of stories would be forgotten, but others would be passed on. This seemed like a great migration story. So that was a hint, too. So I began to look both for Ruth Middleton's, who plausibly could have been in the north, as well as looking at old slavery records of Rose and Ashley.
And I want to just be clear for listeners who don't know, Rose and Ashley are the two women whose names are on the sack. They were both slaves. Mm-hmm. Ruth Middleton was their ancestor. She was not a slave. She was the one who embroidered their names on this sack. So what did you learn in trying to combine Ashley's name, an uncommon slave name, with Rose, a common slave name, and looking for where they were in South Carolina? What did you find out?
The knowing that there was a 9-year-old who had been sold, as tragic as it is, that gives us a hint. It seemed most likely that that would have happened. I mean, of course, sometimes children were sold ordinarily, but usually they were sold with their mothers. But special sales like that usually happened at estate sales after the death of a major slave owner. And from the standpoint of us as historians, that's in a sense a good thing. It's a horrible thing that happened. But it means that there are probably estate records or a good chance, because so many aspects of the lives of enslaved people cannot be recovered. But if they show up in court-ordered records to do with estates, that would be a good thing. So I began to go through thousands and thousands of estate records. Some of those are online. A lot of them are only available in the South Carolina archives, or in some cases in courthouses through rural South Carolina. So I looked at a lot of slave records. And At first, I thought I'd maybe find in the same inventory record a Rose and an Ashley in the same place, and I didn't do that. But then I thought, well, perhaps they were simply owned by the same person and were linked in that way, but they could have been in different estate bundles. And that's what I found in the actually in the Charleston inventory, which is a special document that was fortuitously copied before the Civil War because the original records were destroyed in a fire during the Civil War. On one page, I find a Rose who was owned by a very prominent Charleston merchant, Robert Martin, one of the wealthiest men in Charleston, who left behind one of the most palatial mansions well known in the city. And 100 miles away, this is in a separate set of documents on different pages, were about the names of about 100 slaves whom he owned when he died in 1852. And one of those was the child Ashley. And seeing that they were owned, Rose and Ashley were owned, and then that the estate had to be divided up to raise a lot of money for Robert Martin's white heirs, that put us on the trail.
I know that this is your work. You look into the history of slavery in the United States, but there's also something very compelling and moving about the idea of combing through estate records to learn about what happened to people, to learn about what happened to a mother and her child. What was that? What was
right.
that like?
I think so. I think you're absolutely right. Of course, there's a professional side. I teach. I direct a museum. I spend a lot of time studying objects. But this is different. It seemed like a profound personal and ethical responsibility. We teach our students so often. We study the history of the 4 million enslaved people who were owned, who were human property in 1860 when Lincoln was elected at the beginning of the Civil War. But beyond all those numbers and beyond the staggering wealth that was associated with the slavery system is this profoundly personal story. And, you know, in the middle of this, I began to remember a rabbi who had said in reference to 9/11, you know, it wasn't that 3,000 people died on that day. A person died 3,000 times. And this object gave us the opportunity to honor those specific people, not just the numbers, not just the thousands, the millions, but to honor a very specific story of a mother and a child who were separated. And getting the details right just seemed so important. And it did start to obsess me, I think, over this last year. That's right.
I wonder how often you thought about Ruth Middleton when you were searching for Rose and Ashley and what happened to them. I mean, all Ruth knew about her ancestors were that one of them was sold as a child and separated from her mother, and mm-hmm. she was able to put that on this sack. How often did you think of her and what she didn't know about her family as you searched
I
for
was
them?
So fascinated that she had done that. We have so many amazing oral stories that have come down in African-American history, of course, stories of slavery that were transmitted. But it's very rare that they're written down, and I don't know of any case in which they were written down in needlework in this particular way. And so I was always wondering, well, why would she do that? Why would this story that had come down for perhaps 80 or 90 years orally, why did she feel the need to write it down? But once we were able to figure out who Ruth Middleton was, when I found her marriage certificate in the Philadelphia City Hall, and I realized that she'd probably been pregnant when she was getting married and that her husband had soon after abandoned her. So that means that in 1921, she was a single mother raising a 2-year-old girl up in Philadelphia probably very difficult to reduce circumstances. And now we can at least imagine a scenario. She was telling the story to her little girl, but it wasn't the way that maybe her mother had told her the story back in South Carolina. Now they were in a different place. And something about coming north, being in this new, exciting, but challenging world meant that it wasn't just enough to tell the story surrounded by many relatives, but just mother and daughter. And at that point, she decided to translate, it would seem, the oral story into something written. And she wrote it very beautifully with a great literary skill, I must say. Beautiful needlework, beautiful handwriting, but also just a wonderful way in 54 words of conveying this story. And I could even read those words if you would like that.
I was just going to ask. I had an inkling that you might have them memorized because there's only 54, but if you have them, I'd love to hear it.
My great-grandmother Rose, mother of Ashley, gave her this sack when she was sold at age 9 in South Carolina. It held a tattered dress, 3 handfuls of pecans, a braid of Rose's hair. Told her, "It be filled with my love, always." She never saw her again. Ashley is my grandmother, Ruth Middleton, 1921. So that's all we have of this amazing story, are those 54 words. But so much is packed into them. And the more you read it and think about those words, and she's done it in different colors, very carefully designed. And the largest line in red is, "It be filled with my love always." And the word love comes at the exact center of the needlework, so that it just in large letters fills all this. And for many African-American older women in South Carolina, the moment they see this, they begin to cry. And they say, well, this reminds us of the words of Jesus and the Bible, always in red. And that, they feel, is what sort of woke up the bag. For many of them feel the bag is a sacred object, what they would call kanjo or mojo or obia, a sacred African-influenced tradition of a bag that carries medicine, and that it has to be woken up. And that line, "It be filled with my love always," it just reduces everyone to tears. It's all she could give were those objects and her love, but that the bag became a sort of protective talisman is how they think about it.
You've obviously seen the bag as well, yes?
I have. It's beautifully installed at the new Smithsonian National Museum of African American History and Culture. And I was there for the scholars opening, and it was very exciting. The curators have really done an amazing job. It was beautifully installed at Middleton Place down in South Carolina, but now it's, of course, a national treasure, and it's really in the heart of the new Smithsonian Slavery and Freedom Concourse, which is the first thing you do see when you go into the museum. Just opposite the words of Thomas Jefferson and all the paradoxes of liberty, it's next to a big installation of an actual slave auction block, with a lot of information about the millions and millions of dollars that were bound up in enslaved people. And then just next to it is this very quiet installation of the bag that reminds us of the personal, the human aspects of slavery. It wasn't just a financial and a political system. It meant these sort of human horrors.
Carry me back to old Virginia. There's where the cotton and the corn and taters grow.
As the nation prepares to inaugurate a new president, we've been getting glimpses of some of the communities he will soon lead. Our series is called Finding America. Today we go to Richmond, Virginia.
When people come to Richmond, it really feels like a hipster haven. The first thing you see is a lot of restaurants. You see a lot of social entrepreneurships. You see a lot of boutiques. But I don't want people that look like me to be forgotten in the midst of that.
Historian Free Egunfemi worries that the history of Richmond's black community is getting lost. It's easy enough to find monuments celebrating Confederate history in Richmond. It's harder to find evidence of Richmond's role in the country's slave trade. Unless you go underground, which is what Egunfemi and producer Kelly Libby did. A local restaurant employee led them into a basement that Egunfemi believes was used in the Underground Railroad.
So as we come down in this
hole, you're right.
This basement is actually part of Sweet Tea's restaurant, which is a black-owned soul food restaurant here in Shaco Bottom, in this section of downtown Richmond, Virginia.
Hold your head down when you come down. Come on down.
In this basement, you'll find a very low ceiling. You'll find very old bricks.
Yep. Ouch.
But certainly the ability to understand what this space could have been like in the 1800s. Do you have a flashlight? There's boarded up and bricked up tunnels that were used in the Underground Railroad. So being down here right now today feels so strong because I know that this was the last space in Richmond that many people actually occupied before they whisked themselves to freedom and started a new life in places like Philadelphia.
Good.
Okay. Yes, let me get closer. This was something that I was able to uncover through conversations with the people that live and work here and digging for the untold story. Yeah, did you hear about this when you first came? Did they tell you?
The owner told us about all this.
Richmond, Virginia is the nucleus of the slave trade in Virginia. Because there were at least 300,000 people that were gathered from all over the surrounding counties and brought to ships and sold down the river. It's actually the term that they used. Sold down the river to never see their families again. We are only a few steps from auction blocks on every corner. of this area. They're not marked. There's no memorials. There's no signage. There's no remnants. There's no evidence. All of this stuff has been erased to time.
So you would have to shimmy up that.
Huh? Richmond is a majority black city.
You want to get closer or what?
There's more black people than any other background here in Richmond, Virginia, and our narratives have not been celebrated, nor have our accomplishments.
There's two of them.
This is something that I feel is very important to be told by the descendant community itself, to be held as a historical remnant of all we were able to accomplish when the city and the state and the nation had laws on the books that made us not be able to have life, liberty, or the pursuit of happiness like everyone else. So for my ancestors and for those that were enslaved here, tortured here, disrespected here, I say power to the people. May we never forget what this space represents for self-determination and self-liberation and all the things that go into people preserving their freedom. May it be so.
That's historian Free Egunfemi in Richmond, Virginia. Her story was produced by Kelly Libby. It comes to us from Localore, Finding America, a national production of AIR, the Association of Independents in Radio.
I've been screaming for a Nat Turner movie because I don't like slave movies. Mm-hmm. I've been denounced them. I said, are you going to make any slave movie?
The Underground Railroad has been on America's mind this year. It was the backdrop of a novel called The Underground Railroad that won this year's National Book Award in Fiction, and it was the setting for Underground, an acclaimed new television drama.
We have to go now.
No, we can't. We got the plan.
The upcoming second season adds a new character, and she's based on a real historical figure whose story has been underrepresented in movies and television. Here's NPR's Netta Ulaby.
Underground is filled with wild chases and captures.
Wanted. Seven escaped slaves.
Seven runaways flee a Georgia plantation in 1857 through a treacherous world filled with slave owners, double-crossing slave catchers, double-crossing abolitionists, and enslaved people double-crossing each other.
I trusted you, and my family's torn apart.
They got my pearly maid. They got her.
The first season ends with one of the show's main characters, a runaway maid trying to save her friends, meeting a new character, a dark-skinned woman wielding a rifle.
They said you was looking to steal slaves.
Can't steal something that ain't property in the first place.
Well, I aim to teach you how. Name's Harriet.
Harriet Tubman.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
Veronica Wells, culture editor of the website Madame Noir, is one of the millions of Underground fans so excited about the new Harriet Tubman character, she can't stop saying how excited she is.
I'm so excited. I'm so excited about Harriet Tubman because she doesn't play. She doesn't take any mess.
Harriet Tubman helped more than 100 people find freedom a decade before the Civil War.
The Lord sent you to me to get your family back.
But until now, this intensely dramatic character has barely been featured on screen. Besides a miniseries from 1978, A Woman Called Moses, starring Cecily Tyson.
I will lead my people out of bondage, Lord.
No surprise, says Madame Noir editor Veronica Wells.
She's a black woman, and there haven't been a lot of stories for black women of any time period.
And that's why Wells is excited to see more of Harriet Tubman on the future $20 bill and an upcoming movie starring Viola Davis. On the WGN show Underground, Tubman is played by actress Aisha Hines. When she first stepped on set, Hines, a seasoned theater professional, burst into tears.
Even I get so emotional about it.
Hines did her research and learned Harriet Tubman's nearly superhuman courage came from her total confidence that God was advising her and listening to her.
Trying to dig deep for that level of faith just completely broke me. You know, I felt unworthy. I felt incapable of really, truly honoring the story that she had to tell.
So to play an icon, Hines searched for smaller truths to make Tubman human.
How does she peel potatoes in the kitchen? You know, just simple things that you forget to remember about a person.
Actress Aisha Hines believes there's a reason why Harriet Tubman's story feels so relevant right now.
I think we're in a time that calls for that level of courage, that level of resolve, you know, to be completely disgusted with injustice to the point that you will have to take some huge leaps of faith, and it may take one person leading many.
When the real Harriet Tubman died in 1913, it was in a home for African-American seniors she'd established years earlier. Her final words, "I go to prepare a place for you." Netta Ulibi, NPR News.
Yeah, we made a million a minute. We made a million a minute. Ah! Do anybody feel bad for Bill Cosby? Did he forget the names just like Steve Harvey?
Casey Affleck is a frontrunner for a Best Actor Oscar for his performance in Manchester by the Sea. Allegations of sexual harassment by two female crew members have surfaced from his past, but these accusations have not derailed his career at all. In contrast, Nate Parker, director, writer, and star of the film The Birth of a Nation, was accused of rape in 1999 when he was a student at Penn State. Parker was acquitted. His accuser later committed suicide, and the story clouded the promotion of his passion project earlier this year. Anne Helen Peterson, senior culture writer for BuzzFeed, wrote about the public images of these two actors.
Well, one of the interesting things about Nate Parker is that his image was somewhat unformed until this film, The Birth of a Nation, was released at Sundance last January. He was well known amongst the black movie-going public and had been in several, you know, mainstream Hollywood films, including The Great Debaters, but still wasn't a household name.
Yeah.
Casey Affleck has been a household name almost since the late 90s. He was in a supporting role in Good Will Hunting, which is the movie that made Matt Damon and Ben Affleck household names. And it was a very memorable role. He's kind of a smart alecky backseat brother. And then as Ben Affleck got more famous, Casey Affleck's career was developing, you know, not nearly in the same way, but he was still someone that people knew who he was. He was nominated for an Oscar for his role in the assassination of Jesse James. So he's been part of this Hollywood cognoscenti for a very long time.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, the way that either of the Afflecks or Matt Damon, like the likelihood of a white working class guy succeeding in Hollywood is just more than a black guy. There are more roles for white people. There are more ways to find connections, find mentors, become producers, all these sorts of things. Even though we think that there's no barriers in Hollywood, absolutely there are.
When you look at celebrity profiles in trade publications like Variety and Hollywood Reporter, they barely mention the allegations against Casey Affleck. But that is not the case for Parker, who has had entire articles devoted to the allegations. Is this about also the PR strategy on behalf of these two actors? Did Parker's PR team just fail?
I think Parker's PR team decided that they were going to meet the allegations head on right away. This movie comes out at Sundance. It's a huge hit. No one really knows about this guy. But if you even look at his Wikipedia page, it's like, oh, he was accused of rape. So what are we going to do? We're going to put it out in the open and say, you know, there's nothing to be ashamed of here. This was, you know, he was found not guilty. Let's put it behind us and talk about the movie. And that was their strategy. This started in, you know, late August. And it just completely backfired on them.
How?
Because they made the conversations about the rape front and center. I don't think they had fully considered that the accusation and the trial and everything that was endured by this woman who accused him of rape would become part of the public record, would be readily accessible online. There's no way you can spin that. And Casey Affleck's PR strategy has been, let's just not talk about them at all. You know, maybe people will feel like they need to put a paragraph in there about them or ask one question. But by decentering them from the conversations that he's having, that also decenters them from his image.
Would that have worked for Parker?
I don't think so. Affleck has enough things to talk about with this film. Mm-hmm. You know, there's all of these conversations about your craft in this film, right? And how did Kenneth Lonergan end up casting you instead of Matt Damon? There's these larger conversations of, you know, tortured artist and that sort of thing. Whereas Parker, because his image was so unformed, and also because The Birth of a Nation, the film that he produced and directed and starred in, you know, the plot of it hinges on the rape of a woman.
Right.
Rape is central. Sexual violence is central to this film.
So Casey Affleck is married to the sister of Joaquin Phoenix, a famous actor. He is the little brother of another famous actor, Ben Affleck. And he grew up a block away from another famous actor, Matt Damon. To what extent is his success and the treatment of him after all these allegations a product of privilege?
I think it's all about privilege and its very myriad manifestations. So a lot of people, right after this article came out, would respond to me on Twitter or something, and they'd say, the difference between these two allegations is so simple. It's all race. And absolutely, race is part of it. But it's about white privilege, but also all of the privileges that are clustered around being a powerful person in Hollywood.
And to what extent is this also about women's place in society? Is it easier to dismiss behavior when the behavior is allegedly targeted at women?
Oh, absolutely. And I think it's also easier to dismiss this sort of behavior when it doesn't involve rape. Because one thing that was said to me a lot in the aftermath of this article was that, well, of course, you know, people aren't mad at Casey Affleck. He's just doing what guys do, locker room behavior. He is excused because that's just how patriarchy works. And I think that within that scenario, women are taught over and over again that this is just the way things are.
Anne Helen Peterson, senior culture writer for BuzzFeed, thank you so much for speaking with us.
Thank you so much.
Now, let me just say, we have extraordinary appreciation and respect for the vast majority of police officers who put their lives on the line to protect us every single day. They've got a dangerous job. It is a tough job.
The NYPD's use of stun guns remains a topic of controversy following the fatal tasing of a Bronx man in November and the fatal shooting of a Bronx woman in October. In that case, the officer was criticized by some for using his firearm instead of a taser. Now, in a recent report, an NYPD oversight board appears to have changed its language on the use of stun guns to be less critical. New York Times reporter J. David Goodman says he noticed quite a few changes between a draft report issued by the Civilian Complaint Review Board and its final version released in October. He joins us now to talk about his findings. David, welcome back to WNYC.
Oh, sure. Thanks for having me.
So first, let's get a grip on the number of incidents covered in this report. How often are tasers actually used by NYPD?
Well, right. It's fairly infrequent now, and that's because most officers don't carry tasers yet in New York. It's and this is changing right now, and that's part of the reason why they did a report. For the last few years, it's only been really sergeants and specialized members of the ESU unit that carried them. So what we were looking at is a universe of about 153 complaints about taser usage that came into the CCRB in 2014 and 15. So to give you an idea, that's a small number of the overall about 4,500 or so complaints that came in, I think, each year during that period. So we're talking about a very small fraction of the overall number of complaints. And each of these complaints then has to get verified and checked out. And so of those, the number that they were able to fully investigate and sort of corroborate that the allegation that was made by the person, was they could substantiate it, was only 3 incidents.
Well, let's break it down a little bit, because you did see, even with those small numbers, you did see an initial version of the CCRB report and then noticed some changes when the final report came out. What were those changes?
That's right. Well, what they did was essentially tone down the language of it. They took out phrases that were more critical of the police department. They changed at one point speaking of the use of tasers when a subject was already in police custody, so either in inside a station house or handcuffed. And the original report said that these were the most troubling incidents. That phrase was about them being the most troubling was removed. They also removed a statement about that the review of these police custody complaints supported the perception that tasing in these cases might have occurred unnecessarily. They took that out completely as well. And so there are incidents like that throughout the report. But probably the most notable was that they changed their recommendations section from being an actual recommendations of having a – initially the draft said, the police department should have a kind of report every year like they do with firearm discharges for tasers. The final version didn't have that.
And there's been pushback from the NYPD and the de Blasio administration that the language in the report that was removed, or at least downplayed, was simply superfluous language. Would you agree with that?
Well, they went further than that. I mean, they said that that language skewed the findings, which there may be a case to be made there. It certainly colored the findings in a way that was critical of the police department, and so they removed the language that did that. But for an oversight body, you know, the question we have to ask is whether they're truly providing independent oversight and reaching their own conclusions about the agencies that they're overseeing. City Hall said that they're seeking to have a more collaborative relationship between oversight agencies and the agencies they look at. I'm not sure everyone would agree that that's the best way forward.
Do you expect there to be further reporting on these issues related to tasers going forward?
Yeah, I mean, that's the one thing that they said, you know, in responding to this, is that this is the first of many reports that they anticipate doing. And with the police department now rolling out tasers to more of its patrol officers as a way of sort of trying to de-escalate and move away from the use of firearms in intense situations, we can expect more taser incidents and the more scrutiny of how they're used. And so the CCRB has promised to put out more reports. So we'll just have to wait and see how they're done and how they're interpreted.
I've been speaking with City Hall reporter J. David Goodman of The New York Times. Thanks, David.
Oh, thank you.
Emmy police officers have been fired from the force after making a thoughtless joke about South Florida's predominantly black neighborhoods. Let's go to local 10 news reporter Amy Viteri live now in Miami with her story. Amy.
Well, Calvin, it was the city manager who made the decision to fire those three officers. Miami's police department did an internal investigation into those comments, which happened in a group chat back in June. But it was 2 days before Christmas when each of those officers, still in their probationary period, got a termination letter from the city saying their services were no longer required.
Social media comments came back to haunt three probationary Miami police officers fired December 23rd for remarks about using Miami's primarily black neighborhoods for target practice.
It was in bad taste, and it was an off-color remark.
Attorney Stefan Lopez represents officers Bruce Alson, Kevin Bergness, and Miguel Valdez, whose comments are detailed in this internal memo from Miami Police. In a WhatsApp thread with other officers about finding a shooting range, Bergness writes, "Model City has moving targets." Valdez suggests Overtown. They even run scenarios and pretend like they're shooting heroin, referencing the community's drug epidemic.
We know that there are some officers who have engaged in serious misconduct, who have betrayed the badge, and these officers weren't them.
Lopez says the messages were sent on June 30th while the officers were off duty on their personal phones, and they apologized afterward.
Law enforcement officers in this position should know better.
Community activist Robert Malone feels the officers could have been reprimanded.
And I'm hoping that someone in our community does not use this to kind of explode it and make it be something that it's not.
City manager Daniel Alfonso issued a statement Friday saying comments like those made by the three probationary officers suggesting the use of human beings for target practice do not reflect the community policing principles we advocate. Miami's FOP president fired back, writing, "The manager would rather focus on text messages than the senseless killings and violent crime in the Overtown Model City areas." And the attorney for these officers says there was no racial motivation behind these texts and explains one of the officers is black and another has a grandfather who is black. But in a statement today, Chief Rodolfo Giannis says that their conduct was inconsistent with the department's values. However, their attorney says he plans to file a complaint with the EEOC and will pursue all options for these officers. We're live in Miami. Amy Viteri, Local 10 News.
Like the years before it, a lot of the racial discourse in 2016 was shaped by protest and unrest and amplified by social media. And during the presidential campaign, race often became a polarizing issue, so much so that Donald Trump was only able to attract 8% of all American black voters. As we head into a new year and prepare to inaugurate a new president, we're going to have a frank discussion about race relations right here in Los Angeles with three community activists and leaders who will help shape the conversations in the years to come. Shamel Bell is a PhD student at UCLA and one of the original members of Black Lives Matter. Tyrone Howard is the director of the Black Male Institute at UCLA. And Tyree Boyd Pates is an educator and activist. And here's Tyree's characterization of this year for African Americans living in Los Angeles.
Well, I just wanted to say that sadly in 2016, for African Americans, Los Angeles is still fraught with the same repressive conditions that African Americans have had to deal with for the last 30 years. I mean, much of our concentrated areas are still dilapidated, and the only areas that are developing are the ones that are forced with the threat of gentrification. Political representation is still kind of indistinguishable from candidates, and police relations are collectively still at a deadlock.
Jamel, what about you?
I definitely think things like the metro, police relations, all impact the quality of living for Black Americans in Los Angeles. So it's kind of like 2016 was the worst year ever.
Really?
But like Tyree said, it's the same. The quality of living for Black folks in Los Angeles has definitely been in, you know, a decline this year, but it's not anything that's been different from what we have been seeing in the past.
Tyrone, what about your perspective?
Yeah, I think Shamel and Tyree are spot on in so many ways, and this is the challenge, because what we're seeing is that the struggle continues for Black folks, not only across this country, but in particular here in Los Angeles, where you have massive, massive wealth, yet you got large segments of the Black community and Black population that seems to never be able to gain access to that wealth. So when you talk about the conditions in Black communities, we're still seeing Black folks working for decent wages to support their families. We still see oftentimes limited infrastructure support to enhance those communities in real meaningful ways. We see poverty rates for Blacks in Los Angeles remains among the highest across the county and across the country, for that matter. When it comes to political representation, we know that there's a small pocket of Black politicians who are willing to fight upstream and to bring issues around the unique issues that Black folk face into the focus, but they are oftentimes left on the island and not supported in any kind of real massive way. So I think Black political representation continues to wane, and I think we're going to continue to see it wane in the years to come because of massive demographic shifts. And then when police relations, I mean, we could spend the next 2 hours talking about how that has unfolded over the past of 2016. We know that Black folks are still, by and large, likely to be stopped, harassed, arrested unjustly, and unfortunately, we've seen too many Black lives lost at the hands of police during the course of 2016. So, yes, in lots of ways, to Shamel's point, as much as some things change, it's sad to say some things remain the same.
Shamel, police use of force continues to be a concern in this country. There are changes happening, though. Here in Los Angeles, the family of Brendan Glenn was recently awarded a $4 million settlement for his death at the hands of police in Venice. The L.A. Police Commission unanimously called the actions of the officer out of policy. The officer, though, hasn't been charged. Do cases like this signal to you that the LAPD is paying more attention to the issue?
I don't think that necessarily they're paying more attention. I think it's more of a saving face. You know, and when you think of like changes, think of it in like aesthetic changes, changing something on the outside, but there's an internal problem that can only be addressed at the core. You know, I'm really happy for, you know, them getting money, but what is really happening at a systemic level? That's what we're more concerned about, the, you know, white supremacist patriarchal capital, which is what Black Lives Matter is really fighting against. It's not just police relations. That is a bit of it. That is a part of it. That's a symptom of it. But at the core is the systemic problems that are happening in Los Angeles in particular.
Tyrone, President-elect Donald Trump touted himself as the law and order candidate throughout the whole election, and many people took that to mean that law enforcement would be encouraged to be tougher on crime. Others worry that it may be code for cracking down on communities of color. What does the phrase law and order imply to you, Tyrone?
Yeah, I think for me, law and order implies very much the point you just raised about it being cracking down on communities of color and on African-Americans in particular. We know that President-elect Trump was a big supporter of the whole stop and frisk policies of New York and Mayor Giuliani there, which we know had a disproportionate impact on African American and Latino citizens. So if someone endorses that, obviously they think there's a need to bring an old Western mentality to somehow straighten out black communities and black folks. And I think that's just a deeply disturbed way of how we address the problem. So to me, while we can talk about retraining police officers, helping them to adopt the best practices for engagement with communities of color, I think that's one part of this approach. But I think the deeper-seated part of this situation is the ideologies that inform and guide much of the folks who are out on the patrol. I think these ideologies are sort of steeped in this notion that black and brown folks are not seen as equals. There's a dehumanization that occurs. And so when you talk about law and order, it's guided by this sense that these are folks who are oftentimes not worthy of being treated as human beings, are not due the democratic process that we say that they are due, and therefore it's okay to violate their human rights. It's okay to violate their civil liberties, and it becomes acceptable to say, you know, we can pay you $4 million, but at the end of the day, we still don't hold, you know, police officers accountable for taking lives in very innocent and unfortunate fashion. So, yeah, law and order conveys a lot, and I think, unfortunately, a lot of folks hear that and think that we're going to make our communities safer, we're going to make them better, but there's a real heinous sort of way in which that really plays itself out in the day-to-day lives of folks who live in certain communities.
Well, Tyrone, looking broadly then at the needs of the African-American community in Los Angeles, so what do you think is going to be the most critical factor for continued growth in the next year and beyond?
Yeah, so there's so many factors. I mean, part of what we have to recognize is that growing inequality continues to have a real racial element to it, that we see that poverty continues to impact African-Americans in ways that it doesn't other populations. I also think, and I'm an educator, so I think that the quality of education for African-Americans in 2016 is in need of some significant enhancement. These issues are all intertwined. When we improve the quality of education, we improve the opportunities for families for working wages and living conditions, we improve neighborhoods and communities. So it's really a holistic approach that we have to take. But economic empowerment, better quality education, a real bold and courageous political representation would be three starting points I would begin to focus on.
You know, First Ladies usually have a cause, and you've already said you're interested in speaking out against bullying on social media.
I think it's very important because a lot of children and teenagers are getting hurt, and we need to teach them how to talk to each other, how to treat each other, and to be able to connect with each other on the right way.
It's an ironic choice, since her own husband sent out a stream of pretty nasty tweets during the campaign.
Also tonight, more fallout from those controversial comments made by Carl Paladino. A growing number of community leaders are calling for the local developer to be removed from the Buffalo School Board. Paladino told Our Voice he hopes Obama will die of mad cow disease. He also said First Lady Michelle Obama is a male who should be let loose in Zimbabwe. Now, over the weekend, Paladino's son denounced his father's comments. William Paladino said they are, quote, disrespectful and absolutely unnecessary. With several people now demanding Paladino lose his seat on the school board, 7 Eyewitness News reporter Josh Bazan is taking a closer look at the process.
Outrage continues to spread after comments made by Buffalo School Board member Carl Paladino to Art Voice.
Because of the explicit and graphic nature of it, it was just alarming. I mean, he talked about the decapitating of a human being. He talked about another human being dying from mad cow disease.
Those comments have several community leaders calling for Paladino to resign his position on the school board. County Executive Mark Poloncarz says the statements are racist, and anyone who has these beliefs is unfit to hold public office and especially unfit to oversee the education of children. Sam Radford has children in the Buffalo School District and says there's no place for a school official to be saying these things.
That he should resign and move on and, you know, do that as a citizen and not associate that with the Buffalo Board of Education any kind of way.
But with Paladino standing by what he said, a resignation seems unlikely.
From my perspective, it's time that these things are said. And I say it with all sincerity, and I also say it with a little bit of humor.
That has some wondering if his removal from the board is possible. The short answer, yes, but the long answer, it's complicated. The Hamburg School Board removed one of its members in 2014. Catherine Forcucci appealed the decision, but it was upheld by a judge in August. But that was in Hamburg. The same can't be done in Buffalo.
The board does not have the authority to remove a sitting board member. We don't have the authority to sanction or to censure Mr. Paladino. That is not what we can do.
According to the Buffalo City School bylaws, the authority to remove a board member is left to the current state commissioner of education. There are three criteria for removing a school board member if this issue is brought to the state education department. The commissioner looks to see if a member intentionally broke the law, neglected his duty, or disobeyed an order from the commissioner. A board member can't be removed for only using poor judgment.
Board President Dr. Barbara Nevergold tells me the school board will be issuing a statement tomorrow explaining how they'll be handling this going forward. The next board meeting is January 18th, and Common Council President Darius Pridgen has already offered up the council chambers for what he thinks will be a big crowd. And this is one Facebook event that's organizing a protest for that board meeting. Almost 240 people say they're going, and another 730 are thinking about it. For now, Josh Bazan, 7 Eyewitness News.
I don't want us to lose sight that things are getting better. Each successive generation seems to be making progress in changing attitudes when it comes to race. Doesn't mean we're in a post-racial society. It doesn't mean that racism is eliminated. But, you know, when I talk to Malia and Sasha, and I listen to their friends and I see them interact, they're better than we are. They're better than we were on these issues. And that's true in every community that I've visited all across the country.
Damn you, Obama.
It's a couple of hours trying to clean up that mess that was left behind me. Crews are still hard at work. They've been spraying the walls here that were tagged up with graffiti. A lot of it very inappropriate messages and pictures that we can't even show you on television. But, you know, I spoke to a lot of people in the Tuckahoe area who live very close to the park, and they were not only shocked but so upset to hear about this because Tuckahoe Little League is very near and dear to a lot of people's hearts here in the West End.
Tuckahoe Little League's been around a long time. It's just a part of this area.
Early Thursday morning, park workers found Tuckahoe Little League had been vandalized. Graffiti all over the place, many offensive and vulgar. Broken light fixtures, sinks, and even toilets.
Desensitization that people have, young people especially, to the language and what they're really saying and putting out there. That's disturbing more than anything.
Police think it could have been a group of kids. The park supervisor told CBS 6 the main gate to their property is usually closed overnight and the bathrooms are locked. But the employee who usually does that was sick last night, and the one who filled in didn't know to lock them up.
Besides the fact that, you know, it's just wrong. Vandalism is just wrong. I mean, somebody is destroying, like I said, a vital piece of the neighborhood.
Those who live in Tuckahoe know how busy and important this park is for the community.
There's people up there almost all the time. Always been a safe, great recreational area, outlet, both for the kids and the parents.
And they're hoping police catch whoever tagged up the complex so it never happens again.
Tuckahoe Little League has been around for nearly 60 years, so it's very easy to find people who have been associated with it, who have kids who played, who have no coaches or people involved with the Little League. So that's why it's so upsetting for a lot of people in this area. In the meantime, police are investigating. They were here early this morning documenting the damage, taking pictures of everything. But again, it's very early in the investigation to this vandalism.
Now I really understand what they mean.
The small town of Whitefish, Montana has a big problem on its hands. Mostly known for its natural beauty and excellent skiing, it's now become the latest target of white nationalists, which have sparked protests from some people in the town of 6,000. Whitefish is the part-time home of a man named Richard Spencer. He is a white nationalist and figurehead of the self-professed alt-right movement. Spencer's rise to power has put him and his family under a microscope. Last week, his mother said she was being targeted because of her son's beliefs. In response to her alleged harassment, the founder of the neo-Nazi website, The Daily Stormer, urged his followers to take action against Jewish residents and their supporters in Whitefish.
Their names and addresses were published on a white supremacist website, and they became the targets of a concerted campaign of online hate. Well, to help us understand this story and what happened next, we're joined by Rachel Carol Rivas. She is the coordinator of the Montana Human Rights Network, which has been involved in this story from the beginning, and she joins us today from Helena, Montana. Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Richard Spencer's the white nationalist founder of the so-called alt-right, has lived in Whitefish, Montana, and his parents still live there. Initially, Rachel, what was your organization advocating for in terms of the community standing up against him?
Yeah, so our organization has local members and affiliates across the state, and in the Flathead Valley, the local group Love Lives Here has been doing work combating hate ideas and promoting human rights for years. And that's included passage of a resolution with their city council in Whitefish in support of values that point out the human rights of all and the welcomeness of the community and stand against the hateful ideology of folks like Richard Spencer, and in some cases specifically calling out him. But they've also done educational events and taken on Holocaust denial films and really done cultural events bringing folks together. They celebrated a lighting event for Hanukkah and Christmas this year.
You encourage the local council to take a formal position against him. But what did you want to hear specifically from Richard Spencer's mother, Sherry?
You know, I just think local people were thinking about all kinds of avenues that they can address these issues. And in small towns, that means those conversations that happen on the street corner with people every day. And that included really thinking about ways that Sherry Spencer could take a position denouncing her son's hateful ideology, in which she did, actually. Unfortunately, at the same time, she also made false accusations of being targeted by the community. But that statement denouncing his ideas was important as well, and that did happen.
She has said in her statement that she has been targeted, being harassed to sell a building that she owns. It's a townhouse facility in Whitefish, Montana. She says that people are trying to get her to sell now. That's what she says is happening to her.
Yeah, I mean, I think that there is some uncomfortableness in this local community that Sherry Spencer has profited off the people of the town who have taken a unified stance against her, and she's profited off them while supporting her son's white supremacy. He claims the home address as the address for the National Policy Institute, the white supremacist organization, and supported Richard's efforts in many ways. I think most importantly is that this community is thinking about all avenues to take on using people's areas of expertise and thinking about where folks have connections and relationships, but really always with nonviolent positive strategies for taking on hateful ideologies.
And Rachel, after Richard Spencer's mother, Sherry, put out that statement, that's when there was specific targeting online attacks of people in the community. Who was behind that and who specifically was targeted?
Yeah, so, white supremacists have long been experts at the Internet, which is interesting, and Andrew Algin of the Daily Stormer really took up this cause and targeted the Jewish community and human rights activists in that community. So specifically, members of the Jewish community of Whitefish, which is a small town that does have a substantial Jewish community, were targeted with their photos and their names of their businesses, with Jude and the yellow star over pictures of their faces, and the threats and intimidation and harassment of those individuals and their businesses came flooding in. And since then, you know, they've updated those targets daily to include the local Love Lives Here human rights organization, my organization, the statewide organization, the Montana Human Rights Network, our government officials and local businesses that supported these things, you know, really just like white supremacists have a pretty large target of folks that include a lot of people, so did Andrew Osmond and the Daily Stormer. And they've been, it's been pretty awful for the people there, but the support that's come because of those targets from the community locally and worldwide has been heartening as well.
And as you say, the police have said they've stepped up patrols for certain people in their community, people who have been targeted by this online hatred, as well as, the senators, the elected representatives of Montana have all denounced this. There is, however, a march being called for early January by the Daily Stormer, calling for an armed march on Whitefish. Now, it appears that they're backing down. To what extent would that help resolve this situation?
Oh, I mean, I don't think armed violence or threats of violence or intimidation are ever the answer. And quite frankly, the short-term tactics of intimidation and threats and armed threats are no match for a long-term community-building efforts with education for human rights and relationship building that's really been happening on the ground in this community, like so many communities across the country. But it's no surprise to me that the white supremacists have gone to these tactics. It's nothing new, the use of fear and intimidation, and especially the symbology and the use of guns to instill fear is nothing new, and it's unfortunate, and we can't let the fear that comes with that stop us, and you know, it really won't. It never has. The local community has stood up to these things for a long time.
Just before I let you go, I need to. Do you have any regrets about asking Richard Spencer's mother to take a stand against her son's ideology?
Oh, I mean, we didn't. I don't think that it's ever regretful to work hard for human rights and to ask folks to take a stand against hatred, and that means folks close to these movements as well. So in terms of that, I think it's always important to continue forward and to do the hard work, and I really applaud the people locally who've been on the front lines of saying, hey, hatred is not okay in our local community.
Rachel, thank you for your time today. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Rachel Carol Rivas is the co-director of the Montana Human Rights Network, which has been involved in the story from the beginning. We reached her in Helena, Montana.
May those days, may your days, may your days be merry and bright. Christmas is be white.
The 9-stitch gash on his upper arm isn't the only pain Stephen Sampson says he experienced early Christmas morning when he says he was attacked by 4 thugs wearing ski masks. Sampson says the men also stole $2,500 worth of Christmas presents he bought for his wife and 2 daughters.
I realized at the early end that my gifts were gone.
He says it happened here on the corner of Bolton and Randall Avenues just after midnight Sunday morning. The 41-year-old Sampson, an FDNY EMT and a 9/11 first responder, says he was organizing the presents in the back of his car when trouble came calling.
Hey, cracker, we're going to take your... Basically, that's what they said.
Sampson says one of the men reached for his phone. Bad idea.
He says what the thieves didn't know was that they were messing with the wrong guy. That Sampson is a black belt in judo and aikido.
He says his fighting instinct immediately kicked in, grabbing the first man by the arm.
2 to 3 shots to the arm and I felt his arm pop.
And then taking on a second attacker.
I punched him in the face. He went to the ground.
Sampson says he jumped into his car to get away. That's when he felt his shirt soaked with blood. That's when he realized.
I was stabbed very deep to the bone, and I drove myself to the hospital.
He says it was only after being treated and leaving the hospital that he noticed the gifts for his wife and daughters were gone.
They got a couple of drones, iTunes gift cards, makeup. My daughter's 16, so she likes makeup.
And he says the suspects also got a beating. The NYPD is now investigating. Scott Rappaport, CBS 2 News.
'Cause I'm a liar.
Police say 41-year-old Stephen Sampson made up the story, reporting that 4 men in ski masks stole all of the presents for his family out of his car and stabbed him in the arm. He did get cut on the arm somehow, but police sources tell CBS 2 They still don't know why he lied.
From the hood is the best actors. We the ones that gotta wear our face backwards. Put your frown on before they think you soft. Never smile long or take your defense off. Acting tough so much we start to feel hard. Live from the city where they pull cars. I got a Glock 40 and a Lil 9. Ready for the day a nigga pull mine. Niggas from the hood is the best actors. Gotta learn to speak in ways that's unnatural. Just to make it through the job interviews. If my niggas heard me, they say, damn, what's gotten into you? Just trying to make it, dog, somehow. Peeking through the blinds, I see the sun now. I see it still sleeping and it feels like maybe everything is gonna be alright.
The magic of black music. As the deaths of two musicians recently demonstrates, black music is an art form that radiates freedom, and that radiation flows around the world. The death of Sharon Jones, lead singer for the Dap Kings, is of course tragic in that she died of cancer at the relatively young age of 60. Yet her very being was a celebration of a stellar life force. A woman once told she was too black, too short, and too fat to become a performer. Did just that, and thrilled the hearts, ears, and souls of millions. In their horn-heavy, down-home standard, 100 Days, 100 Nights, Sharon Jones sings a lesson learned of a lover, a hard lesson, to pay attention to whom you lend your heart. Her determination led her to ignore agents and record producers and allowed her to set the stage afire with her blazing spirit. She freed herself and those she blessed with her voice and her powerful dark presence. Across the Atlantic, a Brit of Greek parentage did his own share of lighting the stage afire. Born Georgios Panayiotou in 1963 in East Finchley, North London, England, he became world famous as George Michael of Wham. Like many young Brits of his generation, simply read Boy George, for example. The beats, rhythms, and blues of black music struck their ears and moved them. These artists, raised on Motown sounds, constructed musics based on that dark ore and found fame and fortune. I think what they heard and what they found in black music was precisely what black musicians seeded it with, a yearning for freedom. For it was in the magical realm of music that black folks found their closest vision of freedom to be, to become themselves. That energy was infectious and touched hearts and souls worldwide. Jazz soars in France, in Poland, in Japan. Rap has a deep foothold in London, in Paris, in Tokyo, in Soweto, in Harare, in Berlin, in Marseille, in every city where there are those who are oppressed. George Michael mixed black beats to fuel his pop hits and often used black producers and black musicians to enrich his work. When he came out as gay, he may have shocked the media, but it could be sensed in the subtexts of his songs and felt in his frenetic beats. Black musical beats and rhythms liberated him, freed him to be his self. Because in black music, one finds that yearning for freedom. From imprisoned nation, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal. These commentaries are recorded by Noel Hanrahan of Prison Radio.
Context of White Supremacy, Gus T Renegade, in for another broadcast. hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Saturday, December 31st, 2016. So I have been told the final day of 2016. Mercifully coming to a conclusion. Thank goodness, good riddance. Compensatory call-in. Folks can feel free to dial in, share their views. If you have commentary on the audio clips that we just heard or other events that have taken place over the past week, just suggestions, observations, things that you've seen in your area or elsewhere that you would like to share, feel free to dial in. The number 641-715-3640, and the code is 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you would like to participate. That number again, 641-715-3640. The code is 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you would like to participate. Also, before we get started, this is listener-supported counter-racist radio. Invest if you think the program is constructive. The address for the blog, racism-notes.blogspot.com. racism-notes.blogspot.com. When you visit the blog, look on the right side of the page. You will see the link. Our PayPal button is right there. If you're not into PayPal, drop us an email. We will get you a physical mailing address. Huge thanks to all the folks who have helped out, supported us almost 8 years. Hopefully, we have helped listeners get a better understanding of what white supremacy racism is, how it works. With that, a couple quick things that I want to get to before we get started. Number one, we normally, well, I can't say normally, I know at least for the last, I think, three, maybe 4 years, we've done a counter-racist review at the end of the year, and generally, it's right on New Year's Eve. Generally, it would be at 9 p.m. Eastern, New Year's Eve. But I saw at the very beginning of the year, I looked at the calendar as the year started, just to kind of see some of the dates, and I saw that, like January 1, I saw that the year was going to end on a Saturday. We would already be here for the compensatory call-in. I said, I was trying to figure out what would be the best route to go to just do the compensatory call-in and reschedule the year-end review, or I've spent the last 365 days trying to figure out how to proceed with that, and then as the year proceeded in a most gruesome manner with all of the losses that we suffered over the past 12 months, to me it just became very obvious that any sort of counter-racist year-end review would pretty much just be about 40 minutes of stop and reflection on all of the people that we lost this year. I saw that in May, and the additional losses that we've had since then, it's just been a really unpleasant year, and I mean, that's putting it mildly. In fact, I was thinking, because we did do the end-of-the-year counter-racist review last year, and I said then, and obviously this was before Dr. Welsing had passed, but I said then, just looking at how 2015 went, not that that was a wonderful year for black people either, but just looking at how that year went and how things were concluding with that year, it just did not look like this was going to be full of sunshine and happiness and just great pleasant moments for black people. And it reminded me, I predicted when I went to the White Privilege Conference, I thought that it was going to be a lot of nonsense. I didn't think it was going to be constructive or even an enjoyable experience. And that turned out to be right. And in fact, that turned out to be a major understatement. It was way worse than what I thought. And I remember saying at the end of the conference that it's very rare, at least in my experience, to anticipate or think that something is going to be bad, and then it ends up being significantly worse than what you anticipated. That happened with 2016, like on a personal level, group level, just all the way through. It was just a really, really ugly year. Again, good riddance to 2016. With that, I had said before I didn't want to do the end of the year call-in, and then other people were looking forward to it and expressed their displeasure about the program not happening, which kind of caught me off guard a little bit. I didn't know that was, you know, something people, the end of the year review, I didn't know that was something that people thought about or were vested in terms of kind of looking back and reflecting. I certainly see the constructive value, and it generally is not as sad as the one would be for this year. So I'll have to think if we just want to move it and do it the early part of 2017. I do know that, you know, other people do end of the year kind of reviews and look backs, and sometimes they'll wait until January and then do the look back. So we might plan it out that way. I'll have to see if I've changed my mind. I will say one thing that I do recall that I think is significant, just from the presidential election, which, you know, in my view was not the most important thing that happened this year, but certainly significant. Black people were blamed, criticized, mistreated from beginning to end in that election. And what I remember specifically, this is one of the things that, you know, would be included or will be included if we do the program. Beginning of the year, black people were being excoriated for being so simple-minded, thick-headed, in just blindly following Hillary Clinton, Bill Clinton, first black president of the U.S., and just, you know, maintaining our allegiance to the Clintons. And it was tons of people, white and non-white, who came out at the beginning of the year and fussed at black people and did their finger wagging and wrote all these editorials and, "You're so stupid and lame. Get with the burn, man. Get with the revolution, man. Support Bernie Sanders. What is wrong with you? You're so stupid." Matter of fact, Bill Maher even came out and said he was doing the same thing and saying, you know, Bill, Bernie Sanders' problem is that the brothers aren't down with Bernie Sanders. They're rolling with the Clintons. And he even did a joke. This is like January, February. He did a joke of this year, and he said, "I just don't understand. Why are black people so smitten with the Clintons? I don't understand. You're talking about a white woman with a big behind." Oh, I get in the audience. You got him, Bill. Great one, Bill. Tacky all the way through. Then we get to the end of the year. They came around and fussed at black people again and said, "You didn't come out." President Obama said, "I'll take it personally if you all don't come out and support Hillary Clinton after she won the nomination." It was the exact opposite. Black people are so stupid. And land, you had some of the same people who criticized black people for supporting Hillary Clinton came down and did the exact opposite. And now it was black people are lame and stupid if you don't vote for Hillary Clinton. There's so much on the line, and you're just going to let this narcissist, racist Donald Trump get in the White House because you're so thick-headed and you just want to criticize and critique Hillary Clinton, or don't want to be excited because your Negro Obama isn't running for a third term. How stupid and childish can you be? People said this left and right. Even the black male he writes for the New York Times, Charles Blow, he even had that article. I've read the whole article where he did the same thing. And for me, that's something that stuck out hugely. It doesn't matter. Black people could not vote. Black people could go and vote 100% for Hillary Clinton, go vote 100% for President Obama. Hell, we could go vote 100% for Donald Trump. It doesn't matter. They're going to find some way of, "Oh, the niggas are just messing it up for everybody. Every time they just mess it up." That was one thing that I thought was important that should have been, as I said, it was that amazing for people who fussed at black people at the beginning for voting for Clinton, fussed at black people at the end for not voting for Clinton. Can't win, can't win, can't win. Ode to Michael Jackson. Next thing, that report on the lying EMT worker, Steve Sampson, oh man, that should go down in the archives. Susan Smith, the white woman who lied and said that a black person had stole her car and killed her children. The white woman, Pam, mentions her all the time. She mentioned her in her first book, Trojan Horse, Death of a Dark Nation, where she talked about it. This was a white mother in Pennsylvania where she lied and said that a black person had stolen her vehicle with her daughter in it. And everybody got all worked up. I think they put her on one of those popular daytime talk shows to get more attention, and it turns out she had taken her daughter and they went to like Disney World for some vacation or whatever to go chill out in the sun in Florida. My man Charles Stewart up in Boston, where he shot and killed his pregnant wife and blamed it on a nigger, and they went and ransacked the whole blacks out of town in Boston. This was in the 1980s. You can put that right in the list. And this guy, the thing, it's not just this guy, because there were tons of white people. I don't know if people are familiar with Colin Flaherty. This is a white man, a suspected race soldier. He's been a guest on this program. He was with us back in 2013. He wrote the book White Girl Bleed a Lot, where his thesis, and this is right, if you remember that time, this is right in the middle of the Trayvon Martin shooting and everything, where he was saying that black people have just gone crazy and they're attacking white people left and right and beating up white people, attacking white girls and laughing about it, and nothing is being done. There's no attention to this at all. That's the premise of his whole book. He came on the program and hung up in my face when I was asking him to explain a term in his book. But even Colin Flaherty, he did a big video this week where he included that, and he also connected that incident where Mr. Sampson lied and said that he had been looted by these niggers in New York. He included there were, I guess, a lot of incidents this week in the U.S. at different shopping malls of younger people just showing up and acting crazy, running through the mall and just being disruptive. It happened in a lot of different locations. It seemed to me it was a whole lot of people participating, white people, non-white people. They had videos. They did a lot of stories about this. But he included that as well, to just say, see, the niggers have run wild. We got to get our act together, white people. We got to do something about this, man. This is ridiculous what's happening to white people. It was so much coverage. You heard the segment. It was so serious and sinister, and talking to him when everyone believed he had been robbed and they took his Christmas gifts. And, you know, thank goodness he was trained in martial arts so he could give them a good beating, a good thrashing, thinking that they just attack some weak, wimpy white man. And then, oh, he's been charged with falsifying a report, lying. They didn't have the same enthusiasm, the same excitement in reporting that, oh man, this guy lied and we reported this big thing, trying to make it seem like Negro hooliganism has just run wild. Whoops, our bad. Didn't have nearly the same coverage of, no, this didn't happen. This is just another racist practicing white supremacy, anti-blackness, and specifically lying about black people. And I would love to see, because I know how this type of thing gets down, when he came out and initially reported that at the beginning of the week, how much money, gifts, scholarships for his family and what have you, all of the goodies that white people probably dumped on them. Do you have to return all of that? Is that, because I mean, they can consider that, you know, a part of the crime as well. If you're lying to your advantage and you're going to get some sort of financial gain out of it, they can add that, you know, to the charge. That's fraud, as I understand it. Pay attention. I hope people got that name, and just keep that in mind anytime you hear these sort of allegations that a black person did this to a white person. With that, remind folks, if you want to dial in, if you have commentary you would like to share, the number to dial, 641-715-3640. The code is 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you would like to participate. If you could take approximately 5 minutes or so to share your thoughts, observations, that would be grand. Just make sure that everyone has an opportunity to speak. And then once we get, everybody gets their first turn to share, and then if you have additional comments or questions, whatever you would like to share, we should have ample time to do so. Again, I'll ask for this program, and it's only the compensatory call-in when I make this request, if we could not use metaphors. Again, I've seen consistently when we're having dialogue on racism, white people, they will deliberately employ metaphors to generate confusion, to minimize the war that is being waged against black people in particular, non-white people on the whole. They will compare things that are not equivalent. They do this flagrantly, and they do it all the time. Non-white people, it's been my experience, number one, the racist, their conduct, it has an impact on us. And two, I think a lot of us in our confusion and just trying to figure out the best way to express our thoughts, concepts about counter-racism or racism, a lot of times we're still trying to figure it out ourselves, and so we just rely on metaphors in the hope that that will accurately convey our thoughts, and I submit that a lot of times it does not. It does not add clarity, and even the same thing, a lot of times even we victims of racism end up comparing things that are not equivalent when we talk about racism. So if we could just be explicit, direct, exact to the point about what we mean when we share on the compensatory program, compensatory call-in, no metaphors. Thank you kindly. With that, and if you could watch the background noise, that would be awesome as well. If you know you're in a loud environment and other people are talking and that sort of thing, if you could use your mute button, that would be super appreciated as well. I guess last two quick things that I did want to get in, at least to me, it seems like towards the end of the year, whites are making a really strong effort to get black people to the movies with Fences and Hidden Figures, Denzel Washington in Hidden Figures, and Viola Davis, Hidden Figures with Taraji P. Henson, Octavia Spencer. Octavia Spencer, she was in The Help. She's been in a lot of other projects as well. Taraji P. Henson from Empire and many other projects also. I just, you know, I think for particularly older black people who grew up and they never saw black people on television in any capacity, unless they were just going to be, you know, a janitor, are there to serve white people a cup of coffee or something of that nature. I think for some of those older victims, I think just seeing black people on television is a surprise, probably less so over the last, I would say probably 20 years, because it's so much more common over the last 20 years to see a black person on television. But I think one, sometimes we just think, oh, it's a movie and it's featuring black people, so this is great. And then both of these films, they do explicitly talk about racism. Undeniable. Fences and Hidden Figures. It's kind of at the core of both films, racism directly and being addressed by the characters in it. However, I would say with Fences, and I know that play very well, a lot of anti-blackness that you're going to have to get through. We again have cheating black males and total dysfunction in the family between the father and son and the father and wife. I mean, it's almost reminds me a little bit of Nothing But a Man. You get to see how white supremacy just totally destroys a family, destroys black families, attempted black families. But you're just going to have to sit through a lot of anti-blackness and squabbling, bickering black people. If you check out Fences, if you catch Hidden Figures, I think Dr. Rassayan touched on that last week, helping white people, major theme. And as I wrote in the description, Hidden Figures even includes some of the black people, Octavia Spencer, who were in The Help just from 2011. Whites, no problem glorifying any number of black people who their primary objective, their primary use of time and energy is in service to whites. Last thing, you heard a lot of clips at the beginning about slavery. I just thought that was fascinating because there were so many new segments. All of that was just from the past 7 days. There were so many different reports that were dealing with the enslavement of black people, at least the earlier era of white supremacy enslavement. And I don't know what that means, the symbolism of that, if that's what might even give some clues in terms of what whites have in mind for the plantation, 2017. But I did think that that was interesting because it was just quite a few. And I think there were even other segments that I saw on major mainstream outlets that were also addressing some aspect of the enslavement of black people. Just thought that was noteworthy. If folks have a thought on that, you can feel free to share that as well. Anywho, we will go ahead and get to the first set of folks who dialed in. Star 6 and then 1. If you have commentary you would like to share, folks who dialed in, feel free.
May I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Oh, wow. The first time I ever called in was the first caller. But, well, I know the show is not meant to stroke our egos, but I have to concur with your observations about the elections. Yeah, it seemed that blacks were totally blamed the entire process as if we had any power to control the election. And it's been a tough year. But I will make one observation I noticed this week, and it I know that you hate to talk about the eight area of people when we talk about sexes. An article I read about Serena Williams engaged to a tech genius, and he's a white guy, and I found that highly, well, she's a victim of racism. You know, being her, especially in her situation with her dad, Richard Williams, he seems to know about racism and what she had been through with so many grand slams and people throwing bananas at her. I would think that she would be, you know, more aware of racism and white supremacy. But that's one thing I noticed this weekend. Yeah, it's been a rough year. And I had been listening to, like, some of Nelly Fuller's older clips and Kyle's and trying to get my son on that stuff. And hey, it's working. Some of the stuff is getting through. So I want to thank you for keep broadcasting the program and it's really helping. And I'm you my line.
Glad to hear it. That's great. I got contacted by some other attempted black parents this week who were looking for some of the programs that we did on that. That's great. And logic tends to do that. It tends to get through. I did hear a metaphor in there, stroke our ego. That is a metaphor, I believe. But logic does tend to get through to people.
I was skeptical about that stroke our ego, but what's a better way to say that?
What are you trying to say? That's what I mean. Sometimes we use these metaphors and we ourselves are not totally clear about what we want to say.
Yeah, what I mean is I agree exactly what you're saying. And I know this is not the platform where we agree totally on everything. So I agree. And it's not a pat on the back either.
That's a metaphor too.
So I don't know what to say. You know, I'm still learning.
That's the best thing to say. That is the best thing to say. Because sometimes that's accurate. I don't know what to say, and I'm still learning, followed by sometimes. You can see, as opposed to, because white people would do this a lot of times, and victims would do this a lot of times. And Mr. Fuller has even said that he's made a point of really emphasizing, like, sometimes that's just what to say. I don't really know what to say right now. I'm struggling. Give me a few minutes. I'll get my thoughts together, and then I will try it again. And that's real. Hey, any victim of racism, you are allowed that. I even need that sometimes. You all have heard me say, hey, I'm a victim, and I'm struggling right now. Just give me a few seconds, and I'll see if I can get it together. That's totally acceptable.
Yeah. Awesome, man.
Still learning.
Thanks for the broadcast, man. It's awesome, man.
For sure. Glad you were able to dial in. I think one of the black females that was sharing in Los Angeles, she too said 2016 was the worst year. Like, means like a lot of people had that.
Yeah, it was. It really was. Like so many things that have happened. Like I'm in Louisiana, so the Richard Williams thing, man. I definitely, you know, see some of that, you know, still present today. And when I read that article, I was like, wow, you know, she went off and did it. But, you know, hey, I can't, you know, I don't want to, like, say she's a victim of racism. Just come out and say that, you know, it's kind of like a name-calling thing with Nelly Fuller. So I'm alleging that she's a victim of racism, you know. I'm not really sure, you know, but I'm saying that she might not think that she's a victim of racism. So...
If you could hang tight, that's about five. Okay. I want to make sure we nab other folks who dialed in. Other people that dialed in who have a hand up, if you had commentary you wanted to share, feel free.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Greetings, Gus. Greetings to the callers and the listeners. This is Rob chiming in from Milwaukee. Few observations, piggybacking off of the last caller. The Serena Williams engagement, led me to actually replaying the broadcast of the interview with Richard Williams when he was on BBC. And, white supremacy, I think, and just in those words, white supremacy is a lot being said. And as black people, I'm not really sure if we understand our level of victimization. observation from on the ground where I am, we had the quote-unquote Black Panthers down here, and they were holding a march and specifically saying freedom or die, cracker. And the other day, they just had a demonstration at a food pantry where they were bearing arms outside of the food pantry while they were conducting the business of the food pantry. And Milwaukee Police Department showed up, and the Milwaukee Police Department, I would say, detained some people, and I want to say took a firearm from a black female, and the child of the black female was elbowed in the mouth by a police officer. And it was no physical response from the Black Panthers as the result of the child being hit. Although they were standing by with firearms. And I want to, if I can, I'll chime back in, but I had something I wanted to share that I was reading this morning from Dr. Welsing, but I will have to find it, so I'll chime back in. But I would just like to say, during the holidays, I have felt the powerless position of being a black male under the system of white supremacy. And Dr. Welsing's brilliance of the system is just phenomenal. I really just started to feel the significance of her loss today. And I would like to end by saying, as black people, in the words of Dr. Welsing, my hope is that we can transition to neutral, turn off the emotion like Spock, and study the data. And thank you for letting me share.
Appreciate that. Dr. Frances Cress Welsing. I mentioned her to people who are on my Facebook page. It's facebook.com. The problem is white people. But if you follow on Facebook, I just posted Welsing Moment. It was a commercial, and it featured, it was an insurance commercial, and they were making a comparison between having adequate insurance coverage and getting an adequate tan. And it featured a really pale white person, and then it featured a white female who was like extra, extra, extra tanned. And they were talking about, you know, you're getting the perfect insurance is like getting
a perfect spray tan, total Dr. Welsing moment all the way through white genetic annihilation. Were these the new Black Panthers? I just wanted clarification.
Yes.
Okay. That is just one thing for me, just to minimize confusion, because that's not the same thing as the Black Panther Party. I make an effort, if I'm referring to that group, I make sure to say, to include the new, just to minimize confusion, because I know, yeah, there's a distinction between the two. That I'm so glad you shared. They have VGQ as well. If these are not white people, they have VGQ. I just think that example is important because I do often hear with firearm talk, where people will just say that that's the solution, that Black people just need to get guns, or Black people are cowards, or whatever the case is. There are many examples of Black people fighting back against racism, white supremacy, including killing racists. And I've seen no evidence thus far that Black people having guns intimidates or frightens racist man, racist woman. If anything, a lot of times what I've seen is that just becomes justification for intensifying violence against Black people. Other folks we haven't heard from have commentary?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Greetings to you guys. Greetings to Rob and the other callers and listeners. I thought about, I wanted to chime in regards to the clip you played with Casey Affleck and Nate Parker. I just find that to be just a blatant example of how white supremacy works. A white person can do whatever they want as far as sexual terrorism, and a Black male can be exonerated of all charges, but yet victimized as if he was guilty of the charges that he was exonerated of. That's something that we experience quite often simply because we're not white. And it's something that just happens all the time in the system, where you can be considered not guilty of a crime, but yet treated as if you're guilty. And especially the darker you are, the worse that you're treated in a situation like that. The clip where you talked about, or where they discussed the cops using Black neighborhoods for target practice, I just find that that's a very telling piece of propaganda, because their approach was very nonchalant, as if this was just a rogue statement made by these race soldiers, when in reality that's exactly what's happening. We're being used for target practice in the areas where we reside in this country. And all the deaths of Black people across this country, men, women, and children, should be example enough of the fact that we are being used as target practice. It also makes me think of the rhetorical ethics as far as the media and the way that they approach these things, because even if you look at Chicago, where there are no gun shops within the city limits, it's illegal to own guns, but yet they have the most incredible amount of shootings with high-powered assault weapons that are being dropped in their neighborhoods by white people. So it's just very interesting the way that these things play out. And just in that particular clip, they seem to make it seem as if it was just a rogue statement made by these officers, when that's actually what we see every day in our communities, in the areas in which we reside, I should say. Also, I wanted to I was thinking, if you ever thought about making January 2nd the date of Dr. Welsing's passing and her birthday, days in which we dedicate to celebrating her legacy. That's something that I think, just with the number of times she's been on the show, I'm sure you both have established quite a strong counter-racist relationship in regards to working towards ending white supremacy. So it was something I thought I'd throw out there. I also wanted to say happy birthday to Dr. Ben. His birthday is the 31st of December. And happy birthday to Dr. Clark, whose birthday is the upcoming tomorrow, January 1st. Also, lastly, I don't know if you've seen this, Gus, but I wanted to ask, they have a show that's coming up in January that's dedicated to showing and proving that OJ is innocent of the killings of Nicole Brown Simpson and Ron Goldman. This has been coming up quite often regularly. I've been seeing it even when, like, I'm watching the news in the morning. I've seen it come up before. I don't know if you've actually heard about that, but I think it's called Is OJ Innocent, or something like that.
I think one of you all mentioned it. I haven't been following all the details, right, about the project, so I don't know the people that are putting it together and all of the release date. I don't know any of that information, but I've heard people on this very program speaking about it. They knew this project was coming because I guess there's been so much interest in the case for a long time, and most of the projects in my experience are just, you know, OJ did it, and they were saying that this seemed to have some pretty solid evidence that he did not. But yeah, I don't know a whole lot of details.
Okay, I believe it's Martin Sheen that's behind it, and I remember seeing a documentary years ago on the Bio Channel, which is now defunct, where they discussed this white serial killer who actually took responsibility for those killings, and they said that he was an artist, and he did this artwork, and the artwork that he did was based on the murder scene, and only someone who had intimate knowledge of what happened would have been able to draw artwork that so intimately displayed, what happened. So it's just very interesting to watch that unfold, and we'll see what happens, but I believe it's Martin Sheen behind it. And lastly, I just wanted to say to you guys, thank you so much for all the hard work that you do. It's greatly appreciated. Just you are a very strong inspiration for me in regards to just helping me keep my focus on ending white supremacy and improving my dealings with other black people as far as removing the anti-blackness. This program has just been essential to my growth and development, so I'd like to say thank you so much for the great work that you do. I think Dr. Welsing would implore us to do so because we just never know what can happen to any of us, so I'd like to just take this moment to just tell you how I feel about the show and the work that you're doing, and that I appreciate you quite a bit. Thank you, and I'll mute my line.
Much obliged, much obliged. Well said is also about the both Dr. Welsing and for sure appreciate folks remembering all of her hard work as well. But the commentary about the Miami enforcement officers using black people for target practice, I was reminded, I guess retired firefighter in Florida might know better, but I think it was in Florida where they had the police department where they were using literally photographs of black people, black citizens in Florida, literally using them for target practice. They didn't just have, you know, the bullseye or whatever. They had to put a picture of a black person up for target practice, and they got in trouble and then tried to make a whole lot of excuses about this. But I think that was in Florida, too. Other folks that we have not heard from, do you have commentary? Your line should be open.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Good evening to everybody. 2812. Hope everybody's having a little bit of time off. A couple of observations, and then I just wanted to fill in on some things that I've missed over the last couple of weeks. In reference to Nate Parker, the one thing that I always go back to is that Mr. Parker, before Birth of a Nation, did 20 films. Out of those 20 films, he did one with Spike Lee, Steven Spielberg, and Denzel Washington. Also acted in a couple of different movies with Richard Gere and did plays, and obviously none of that stuff was ever brought up. The reason why I bring those particular films up is, you know, those are very well-respected people, and I'm sure that they did their background, so it just shows you how the system of racism just works. There is one thing that I did want to mention. I sent Gus an article. Maybe I'm not sure if he got to read it because he gets so many different things, but about the pardoning of Jack Johnson for having inappropriate relationships with white women. It's on The Undefeated. I found that to be a very, very interesting article, and even John McCain saying that this is a travesty and this needs to be pardoned. It's very interesting. Another thing is that my kids play sports. And so, in the area of sports, quote unquote, entertainment, what I've noticed recently, particularly on television, is there are a lot of new shows that have this dynamic. And I'm sure a lot of you guys may or may not be familiar with the show First Take, where you used to have Skip Bayless and Stephen A. Smith. There are now about six or seven shows that have that same dynamic of a white male and a black male arguing. And so I'm really just trying to figure out specifically what the system of white supremacy is trying to do with that, particularly because the majority of the black males always have the same position in how they are communicating. It's either yelling or angry or taking a quote-unquote pro-black position, whatever that means. I was also traveling to the Bahamas a couple of weeks ago. I think I mentioned it. Had a few constructive conversations there. Talked to a lot of different victims about racism. I actually was talking to a gentleman sitting down, and we were just having a drink, and he had stated, I stated to him, you know, why white people love the Caribbean so much. And he was like, why? I said, I believe it's the closest thing you get to antebellum slavery. All you see is servitude. And he kind of looked at me. He said, you know, I never thought about that. Because I said, well, I don't see them clamoring to Europe this way. Seems like they always clamor down here. So, and he said, you know, I'll have to do some thinking about that. Then I had another conversation with a black female today and my massage therapist. And she made a statement saying that you sound so doomy and gloomy when you're talking about being a victim of racism. And at first, I was like, man, you know, this is not going well. And we weren't arguing. But then I remember Mr. Fuller on one of his episodes, he said, people always say I do sound doomy and gloomy, but it's only because of the fact that I'm being truthful. And the statement that I followed up with her says, well, if racism and white supremacy hasn't ended, it's logical to say that every time a non-white person has a child, that child is eligible for mistreatment. And would you agree with that? And she said, kind of, that does kind of make sense. So I said, don't you think we should try to figure out different ways to end this problem? And then she said, yeah, okay. The reason why I mentioned that is because sometimes myself, and I know I'm getting 5 minutes and I'll shut up, but sometimes we get frustrated with other victims. And I remember I always listen to Gus's programs, and when he says he's done 1,500 programs plus, it reminds us all that Gus, nor any of us that have ever gotten to this point of being less confused, it didn't happen in a day. You know, listening to the cows, reading Dr. Welsing's work, and doing everything, it didn't happen in a day. So it's just continuing to be less patient, to be more patient with other victims. And then there's one last thing, and it's from the ISIS papers. I was reading it on a plane, and this line that Dr. Welsing had wrote, it's just so profound, and it says, those who will to work for justice and who understand that work is their conscious responsibility will be found in all places and in all walks of life, at all levels of formal education and at all income levels. And I just think that that's so profound from her, because she basically just means that it doesn't matter how many coins you have, we can all solve this problem. I'm going to just say to what Roz said, Gus, you do a fantastic job. I know you don't consider yourself successful, but we appreciate the work and all you've done. And I'll mute my line.
Much obliged. Other folks that we have not heard from, feel free to get a hand up. Please do not wait until the last minute. If you have a comment or question, go ahead, press *6, followed by the #1. We will get your hand and get you on the line. Other people that we have not heard from yet, feel free.
Can I be heard?
I heard both of you. We'll get our caller okay. in Ohio.
Go ahead. No, you let the, I think the retired firefighter, you let him go first, okay?
Right on. Much obliged.
Thank you. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Greetings to everybody. Yes, Gus T Renegade. Yes, that was in, I believe, North Miami, Florida, with the targets with the black males on it. There was a series of complaints, and somehow the story disappeared. I'm not sure on what was the final results of it. But normal shenanigans down here in South Florida, and I'm pretty sure it's in common with white people all over the world in some aspect, if not shooting at black people for real. yes, I really don't have a whole lot to talk about. Primarily during this time of during this particular period of time, since it's popular to be quote unquote upbeat and partying It's a quote-unquote neighbor down the street that seems to have a whole lot of time and energy and money with explosives. And it's not even, it still is about an hour away from that period of time for me to cut off these lights in this house and sit down on the floor. Because down here in Miami Gardens, they don't shoot up in the air. They shoot diagonally. Nevertheless, my mindset is during this time of year is to always work to try to train my mind to try to do my waking hours is, okay, well, let me find something constructive to do or get something done of constructive value as opposed to quote-unquote celebrating. Because as Mr. Fuller says, we don't qualify to celebrate anything. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
May I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Hello. To you, Gus, the host, and to the caller. This is really kind of sad that the retired firefighter really got to turn off his lights and sit on the floor because people are going to be shooting horizontally into people's houses. So, you know, this may, it, you know, like you said, Lily Fuller said, we don't qualify to celebrate anything. And if we have to do stuff like that, then maybe we don't need to celebrate anything. So I just wanted to say that. Just a couple of few things, and then I'll mute myself. Last night, listening to Gwen Ifill, listening to the program with her book, I really want to thank, it was something you said last night, Gus the host said last night about, what is it, how white people were saying, oh, no, I'm not going to support Donald Trump, blah, blah, blah. And you have prominent Republicans, oh, he's not qualified. And then, like I said, when he got the nomination, well, we're going to report, you know, support the nomination. And then, you know, the 53% of the white women. But then Gwen Ifill's book, she was talking about Cory Booker, and he does nothing for me. But 1842, when she came on, she made some comments. And she was saying that it's just like the, what we call mulattoes or biracials, that they're the new black people. And so I'm a brown skinned sister. So I guess black people like me and any of us that's maybe darker than me or, you know, brown skin, I guess we just don't count, period. Because white people are basically taking these, you know, mulattoes or biracials to be the black people that they're willing to deal with. And so, when she said that, I just thought, I said, wow, that's just a perfect statement she made, because I have been looking at it. It just looked like to me that these mulattoes are the ones, biracials, I'm sorry, everybody has the word mulattoes, that they're looking to. Even Harold Ford's name, and I know he's not biracial as far as I know, he's just really, really bright, but even his name has come back in. I understand he and his white wife, they done had a baby, you know, so you can see some things. So I just wanted to comment on that. I just thought that was in 1842, statement. I just thought that was very a very good statement. In terms of some things you said tonight with the Hillary Clinton thing, I agree with you 100%. Even when the primary first was beginning, and it was just things I was looking at, and I told somebody, I said, the setup is, I said, I'm telling you now, if Hillary Clinton loses, then that's going to be like, it's black people's fault, totally black people's fault. I said, that's the setup. And after she lost, even though she got 93% of the black woman vote, 80, I think it was either 80 or 88% of the black males vote, it's still our fault that she lost, you know. And, you know, it's just the political madness of it. And it really makes you kind of angry. But I always kind of felt that was the setup. If she lost, it was going to be our fault. You know, President Obama's basically telling us, you know, black people, it's my legacy, it's your responsibility to make sure my legacy. And I'm just like, well, you know, kind of, maybe you should have talked to some of the illegal immigrants and the LGBTQ, the alphabet organization, because you see, you did more for them that they should be help protecting your legacy, because they have a lot to lose with Donald Trump being the president. But be that as it may, you know. So I thought that was a very good point. The things that Mamu was saying about the music, the young lady with the dap teams, George Michael, I thought that was just some very interesting, you know, that was some very interesting points too. But also, God, it was something Something else. Oh, Roz talked about this thing with O.J. Simpson. So I've seen the commercial advertised for that, and it's going to be on the ID channel, Investigative Discovery channel, which is the crime channel. And I just say, if you ever want to see how white people kill up folks, it is the channel to watch. But I understand in January they are having this program that come on and pretty much is saying that, you know, O.J. Simpson is, you know, I guess they're going to try to prove that he's innocent. So, you know, I just wanted to say that. It was something else that's escaping my mind now, but I'll mute myself and maybe later on I'll come back. Thank you, though.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Awesome. This is Ken Steele, and I'm reporting live from Rancho Cucamonga here in Southern California. And I say that because earlier in the broadcast, there was a report from Los Angeles, I believe it was on KPCC, where they were going over the, I guess, year in review for non-white victims of racism classified as black in Los Angeles. And I had to say, I haven't been here for that long, but if things are as bad as they describe, I'm kind of nervous, because my initial interpretation of this particular region is that the white supremacy that is practiced here is far more refined, and it's far less vicious, outright vicious, as the white supremacy that is practiced in the Midwest. And I mentioned that because earlier there was a discussion of new Black Panther Party participants in Milwaukee. And it's interesting that that has come up because I observed some members of the new Black Panther Party on Facebook, and I do agree with the principle of DGQ, but in my estimation, they were not being as codified as they ought to be with respect to their presence on social media. They were using racial slurs to describe white people in very inflammatory ways. They are brandishing firearms throughout many of their photos. And by the way, they're bragging about having the police, or rather having an organization, I think it's Blue Lives Matter or whatever. They are all over their Facebook saying that they're, you know, requesting meetings, and they're taunting each other, and both groups are going back and forth, and it does not seem very constructive, and it looks like either these people are being protected, because I don't know how you can be brandishing firearms and talking about police like this on Facebook without being taken down, because I've seen people and heard reports of people being taken down for saying a lot less. Anyway, these guys are showing out, or rather, these guys are showing off, and it made me nervous. I mentioned this to them, that they ought to, you know, kind of change their behavior, but they seemed very, very confused about the situation that they were in. So I really do caution people to be very careful around those types. I just got a really, really bad feeling after running into these guys. And then also, to speak of the Midwest, I was in Chicago earlier this year. And yeah, the killing there, the people that are from those neighborhoods where the killings are happening have reported to me that they don't even know who is responsible for many of the killings that are going on in those areas. And in this last year, I personally have had three friends directly affected by this, either witnessing a traumatic event or having an attempt on their lives themselves. So this is something that is very real, that is happening. And I suspect that much of the violence is suspected white supremacists, or rather in this case would be race soldiers, going about having fun, doing target practice. And here's another thing. The comment section on the news pages in Chicago, Milwaukee, Ohio, all of these Midwestern cities, I've seen comment pages from all over the country. There's a particular brand of viciousness that is going on within the Midwestern region of this country on those comment sections. Some of the things that the people are talking about are extremely graphic. You know, they talk about, you know, running black people over. They talk about shooting black people. They talk about it's incredibly violent, and it's something that I haven't really observed as extreme as a fashion here in Southern California. And also, speaking of the Midwest, a couple weeks ago, or maybe last week, I reported that suspected racists that are in these rant videos that are appearing on the news, their identities are being protected by the news media. Recently, there was a suspected victim of racism that was charged with simple battery of Jennifer Boyle, who was the person, who was the woman in the rant that took place in the Michaels in Lakeview. She was, she apparently reported this guy for battery. And when the trial came up, she did not show up for trial, so the charges were dropped. And neighbors also reported that the victim of racism that was accused of assaulting her never did anything of the sort. And this is just typical white supremacy that is practiced by female suspected white supremacists, or I guess in this case, white supremacists. And that's something that definitely... I think it's worth noting it took place in the Midwest as well. Also, finally, on the subject of racist women or suspected racist women, you know, the deaths of Carrie Fisher and Debbie Reynolds, their deaths, unlike the deaths of victims of racism, are being celebrity victims of racism. They're being categorized as mysteries. I don't know if you've noticed this, but there was a report that came out earlier today that said that there is currently no official cause of death for Carrie Fisher, even though that we know that she has had a history of drug and alcohol abuse. This is in contrast with Prince, for example, where we knew that he supposedly was buying too much cough medicine at this at a Walgreens, and then we come up with all sorts of stories about he was abusing opiates, even though he had no history of was reported to us as an abuser of these sort of things. And another person, another suspected racist, I believe it was George Michael, his death is also being ruled as inconclusive and a mystery, when we also know that he was engaging in behavior that exhibited symptoms of having HIV. I'm not going to say that he had that or anything like that, but apparently he had a really bad case of pneumonia that almost killed him, and that sort of condition is associated with HIV and AIDS, and his death is also being reported as a mystery. And this is in very stark contrast with the celebrities that died that were victims of racism. So I think that that should be noted by our listeners. I will stop there. I think that's my 5 minutes. Also, wait, I just want to say before I go, thanks a lot for this program, Gus. This is very, very constructive. It's some of the most constructive programming that I think is being produced for the effort of replacing the system of racism with a system of justice. So thanks. This is, you know, just incredible. I'll move on.
Much obliged. Other folks who have not chimed in, if you have not shared, please do not wait till the last minute. If you have a hand up, line should be open.
Hello.
I'll be heard.
I heard both of you. We'll get the female caller, 7656.
Oh, okay. Thank you so much. Thanks for taking my call. To echo the other comments, you know, thank you for having this program. I've learned a lot, and I want to say thank you to other people who comment. They've brought a lot of insight. So, you know, congratulations. But thank you to you all as well. I know we're not supposed to promote watching TV and stuff, and I'm not promoting that. But I was clicking through the channels, and I saw this movie. I wasn't watching it. It was called Barbed Wire. I guess it came out 20 years, some years ago, a long time ago. And I was like, oh, I don't want to watch this stupid movie anyway. But to look at the description, it said something had happened, and it was a second Civil War, a second American Civil War in 2017. I go, oh, wow, okay. I just thought, of course, I thought that was interesting. So I tried to read up on it because, of course, I don't want to watch this movie. So I'm looking to see what it's about. I'm like, what's the problem with the Civil War? What is it about? And so I found a little blurb on the movie, and it says, a second American Civil War. I'm reading a sentence from the description. A second American Civil War has left the country under the regime of dour, jackbooted Federalistas, but Barb Wire, the main character, blah, 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 goes on about her. So I was like, okay, so what does dour and jackbooted mean? So I looked up dour, and when I did, it said, like, very serious, very severe, very harsh, kind of what people think about the incoming administration and his people. And specifically, it says it's an adjective, relentlessly severe, stern, or gloomy in manner or appearance. And then I looked up jackbooted to see what that meant. And I was like, okay. It meant it's a noun actually describing a boot, but it's also used as a symbol for cruel or authoritarian, behavior or rule. And I went, oh, wow. I don't think it's a coincidence that even though this movie was made 20 years ago, the newest administration is coming in, these white people have real problems. They are showing that they have problems among each other based on the regime. Well, I guess you can call it regime, or the new administration that's come into place. And I just really thought that was a coincidence. And I was thinking of, like, the Color Monitors book, and because you had played that again online, so I was interested in that. And in this particular movie, there's a black lady, and she's like the machine who's come up with some idea to help go against the regime or something, so they have to protect her and all this kind of stuff that I read on Wikipedia. Like I said, I'm not going to watch the movie, have no plans to, but I thought that was interesting. That the movie 20 years ago talked about the Civil War in 2017 and described the regime that people believe is coming into place. Thank you. I don't have any more comments right now.
Interesting. She went to look up, get more definitions. I always appreciate that. Interesting. There was a male caller who spoke up simultaneously. Were you going to share also?
Yes. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Greetings, Gus, and greetings to everybody on the call. I wanted to comment on the, I guess, about the Richard Spencer audio that you played. Once again, they were talking about his hometown and was referring to his mother having all these death threats. Obviously, we all know with white people and under white supremacy, they like to turn around and become the victims, you know, to take the attention away from, you know, the real problem. So that was very interesting how they were talking about how she was getting these threats. And, oh, my God, another white woman is being, you know, abused. So that's, you know, that was like, oh, my God, here we go again. So I thought that was pretty interesting. I got to say this. This is my first year listening to the Cows. And I thought, you know, besides the fact that, you know, there are some things that I disagree with, I found this show, you know, pretty productive in regards to seeing white supremacy. I have picked up a couple of things in regards to
white supremacy and white people. The one thing that I've learned, you know, with my first year listening to this show is white people do not want to have a real conversation about race. With the white guests that you had on your show, it's very obvious that I have heard that. And also, too, it has really, really sharpened my view on the behavior of white people and their actions and how they participate in white supremacy. And it also sharpened my view on non-white people in relation to the system and, you know, how we can be easily confused on it. You know, obviously, we all are learning. I'm still learning. Even, you know, previously listening to the show, you know, I've read Dr. Welsing's book a couple of years ago, read Neely Fuller's book a couple of years ago. So I was very familiar with him before listening to the show. But now I'm starting to kind of, you know, really, really get into the, you know, the definitions of what those two scholars were talking about. So really appreciate the show, and I will continue to listen as long as I can. So thanks, and I'll mute my line.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Good evening, everyone. My reflection on the year, and this is Karma. I have to say thank you so much for the show, guys. Thank you for especially teaching me how to combat when people come up to me and say, oh, you black people, you didn't vote. That's why Donald Trump is in the White House now. You should have voted for Hillary. But, I mean, this is what I get from black people. And so now, because of COWS, I can say with some clarity that, no, the reason Hillary Rodham Clinton didn't win the election was because she couldn't carry her base. Black people are only like 13% of the population. White people are like 65%+ of the population in most places, and she couldn't carry white women. Who in the world expects to win an election when they can't even carry their own base? And that usually shuts everyone up. So, I mean, you know, I just thank you for that, because people have been throwing that in my face, and I'm like, we had nothing to do with that. That was just her being inadequate. So, and thank you for giving me that. And the next thing, I've been thinking about the racism white supremacy model, and of course, the problem is white people. But I have a model. I have a new model. At first I had the cancer model, but at the end of this year I have a viral model, which is a refinement of the cancer model, because viruses are infectious agents that can only, you know, replicate inside other living cells and organisms, you know, and they can kill anything. So, and that's what white people do. And people say, like, viruses are like organisms at the edge of life. So, you know, while white people are describing us as life unworthy of life, they are the imitation of life. And so what we need to do in this, the closest I can come to a biological model, is do our research as if they were a virus, but on a macroscopic level. And I think that would be a great place to start. At least that's where my thinking has gotten me this year. And the last thing is, in the article at the beginning when they were talking about the grandparent, well, I guess the great-great-grandmother and the great-great-grandmother, Rose and Aurelia, Rose, and I can't remember, but they were saying, oh, they were sold, you know. Most of the children were sold with their mothers. That's not what we read. When we were doing the book review, it wasn't a book, it was a book review. I remember one example was given of 2,000 black women being cataloged as being sold, and something like 2% of them were sold with their children. White people kidnap black children all the time from their families. They have never, that is not a reliable practice of selling children with their families. And even here in Texas, they're getting ready to shut down the child welfare boards again for kidnapping and mistreating all of these non-white children. And on a positive note, positive note. I think I kept the school from being closed this year by all my attention, because it is a 82% non-white school, and Texas has been closing those with impunity all over the place. And I think the fact that I made some people aware of that situation made a lot of white people go directly to their congresspeople. And even though nothing's changed, we kept that school open for another year. Then that gives me a year to try and find something new. Oh, and one more thing. This will sound interesting. We do have one of those genius mathematicians, black female mathematicians that worked at NASA. She lives here in our community, and she was saying, just last weekend, her husband was talking, and he said, yeah, I remember when they called my wife to come and do the calculations for NASA, and she said she wouldn't go because, you know, they said they just wanted her to go. And they said, well, what would it take for you to come? And she said, well, my husband would have to have a job, too. And so they told me, they said, yeah, but so, okay, we can find a job for him. They said, well, what should we pay him? She said, well, you pay him the same thing you pay me. And so they both went off to NASA. And I thought that was a great ending. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Black self-respect. That's grand. And that is job well done. Your efforts to keep the school from being shut down. That is spectacular. You sound a little bit better than you were yesterday. Still room for improvement, but you sound like you are taking care of yourself. Glad to hear it. Other people that we have not heard from at all. We have any folks that have not shared their views. If you have a hand up, line should be open.
May I be heard?
I heard both of you. We'll get, I think that's our caller in New Jersey.
New Jersey, yes. This is Jersey Girl. I just want to say that I'm very happy to be here. And piggybacking on what the lady just said, I just hope that, Gus, that you take care of yourself throughout this new year, because we need you to bring the people that you bring to us to keep us sane. It's so heartbreaking when you hear about people passing away because they're not taking care of themselves with something simple. That's really, really hard, other than someone who's been, you know, terminally ill or something like that. So that goes out to all the listeners here. I hope you, when men and women are taking care of yourself, because we're going to need to be stronger than ever to keep the fight going. And basically, that's all I have to say. I couldn't spend a better New Year with like-minded people. Thank you so much.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Greetings to Gus, the host, the listeners, and the callers. I just wanted to say about sharing the show. Sometimes I'm just a little surprised that whenever an event is created, like on Facebook, and on Facebook as one of the social media sites, there's not a whole lot of people who are invited. I see a lot of local events that go on just, in my city, and it might be a few hundred people that get invited. And I think that we should go ahead and do that type of model. I don't know how much it will change the way that the show is set up. And I'm not trying to do that at all, but I do think that it's important to share the show so that it can get out to as many people as possible so that we can solve this problem of racism, white supremacy. Sometimes I'm surprised that there's not over 100,000 invites to the event. And maybe there can be a special event to where we can actually go out and send these invites on our social media platforms. And perhaps the event could be to where you're explaining racism again, but giving a full overview. Instead of when people, check into the show, they may be coming into an explanation of racism that is not the full explanation, where we could get the full overview. And then the other thing is, we have between 1 and 2 billion people on the continent of Africa, and we're really going to need some reinforcement for what's coming. as far as what the ICE albinos have in place, have in mind for us, or have planned for us, or the people who call themselves white, what they have planned for us, we're really going to need some backup or some reinforcement, however we can get it. So maybe if you could do a program where we can even invite people from the different African continent as the Africans are on the continent. I just wanted to share that again. I think it's really important to share the show. I don't know exactly how we're going to solve racism if we don't talk about it. Thank you.
Those are good suggestions. We do have listeners in South Africa. That would be grand to incorporate more of them, and even folks who, some of them did participate in the Global Sunday Talk on Racism and are looking forward to do so again, and other folks who just listened. But yeah, we do have CoWS listeners who are on the continent, and there are a lot of black people, period, on the continent who are victims of racism, and a lot of them can speak English. So absolutely, that should be something all of us should be thinking about and trying to incorporate them, get more listeners, and get more participation as well. Oh, and Karma, I thought that was a really important point as well about the terrorism directed against enslaved black children. I think that was Edward Baptist, The Half Has Never Been Told, where he talked explicitly about children. I think he even gave like detailed examples of them taking like a group of enslaved black people. They had them in chains. They're taking them down the road. And one of the black females, she had just had a newborn, and the white racist, the terrorist, he didn't want to hear this black child yelling anymore. So they just stopped at a spot, and he just sold the child for like, you know, a nickel or something. Just like, you know, give me a shilling. I'm tired of listening to this, you know, nigger wind here. Here, give me the baby. And just, I think he detailed that explicitly in The Half Has Never Been Told. So yeah, I'm really, really glad she brought that point up as well. Other folks we have not heard from at all. You should share now. Please do not wait till the last minute.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Good evening, Gus. Good evening to all of the callers and everyone who is listening. Peace to you all, and may all of you have a happy new year. While, yes, this was a rough year, I've thought about that often as it's concluded, I am happy to announce that at the beginning of the year, I had one resolution, and that was to become comfortable in not only my blackness, but the fact that a lot of people around me saw my comfort in my blackness as a threat. And I feel I have actually accomplished that. This coming up year, I hope to actualize some plans that teach other people to likewise be comfortable in their blackness, and hopefully develop some comfort and some strength to kind of penetrate the racism, which is very prevalent in the location which I live. By the way, this is V from Central New York, because I didn't open up with that fact. Gus, you are doing a wonderful, wonderful job, and it is immeasurable, the value of the cows. As I said, in the new year, I plan on becoming a sponsor, a continuous sponsor, hopefully throughout the entire year, because I believe your work is so vital to the black community. One gift that I hope you will all indulge in, I was doing some statistical research earlier, and I stumbled onto this marvelous Pew Research paper called The 10 Demographic Trends That Are Shaping the U.S. and the World. It is all about color and race. And outside of the statistics that are used, I thought that some of the colors were also very interesting, as they decided to use tan to represent white people, and a very dark tan, may I say, almost a brown, and a lighter tan color to represent black people. Moreover, in the same research, specifically in the, I think it's the second graph, if you look it up, you will see that they have black growth as pretty steady. It's about, I think it's 9%, and the growth is steady for the next 3 or 4 decades. How they plan on accomplishing that is beyond me. But anyway, please check that out. It is an amazing, amazing read. Finally, I would like to say blessings, of course, to the ancestors who have passed, specifically Francis Cress Welsing, who I did have a joy of a time talking with. The one brief moment I talked to her, and I hope she can see what she has brought into being, as I hope you, Gus, can at least have a sense of what you've brought into being. I think the cows, especially moving forward into the future, will have set a strong foundation to help people who are going to be wrestling with the realities that are going to be presented to black people over the coming 3 years. The cows would have set a foundation strong enough for them to find a root on in order to grow up and to become their beautiful black selves. Again, thank you very much. All of you have a great night and a happy new year.
Right on. 1842, were you going to share?
Thank you. Can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
I'll say this really quick. You guys are so quick with your mute button. I never get my finger there fast enough. But as you said, this is 1842, so greetings all of you all on the call. I will, before I begin saying some of the notes, I will echo what so many of the previous callers have said. I am new to the cows. I listened to the cows. First, I thought it was just a podcast. Like, I don't know. I wasn't really understanding that I could call in, and then I didn't know how to catch the show. So for a long time, I was only listening to the podcast earlier this year, and then I began participating. I think Workplace Racism was my first one. And so although 2016 has been a very difficult year for many reasons, it has probably been one of my more transformative years. Just because of the cows. And of course, naturally, Gus T Renegade and Justice, but all of the people who participate, because some of you guys are really funny and have really great insights. And so I was always looking for this space. And so, like, New Year, I will let y'all don't know me, so I'll say this. I don't celebrate any holidays, but New Year's is the holiday for me. Like, I was the person who was like, I'm about to get fly, I'm about to be seen, I'm about to dance the night away and bring this New Year in. And I totally did not want to do that whatsoever because I did not want to miss the compensatory call-in. And I really would rather be in my stretchy pants with my notes, listening to the news and talking with you all. So thank you, everybody. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. And okay, on to the notes. So, you know, it must be really nice to be white and make your money talking about, like, piecing together broken black people's history. For the story for Sarah and Ashley, that is what I was thinking about. I have my, I went to school and I have a degree in African American studies or whatever. No way, shape, or form was I able to make money by sitting around piecing together, you know, stories. But this white man can go and be like, you know, I saw this and was fascinated and I began to search the archives and blah, 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 and put the stories together. I mean, y'all disrupted it and still built a name off of trying to piece it together, and everyone's looking at you and all. That was one of the things I took away from that clip is, I mean, goodness, it must just
be fantastic to be white. Like, you can do no wrong whatsoever. And so anyway, and then I didn't like, not, well, it wasn't constructive and it was inaccurate how he said that black people left the South. And I forget who I heard say it first. This is not an original thought of 1842, but where we were refugees, we fled the South. And because of the terrorism that we were experiencing in the South, we fled to the North to seek refuge, where we met, again, terroristic whites and white supremacy. And so I think it's important how we even subtly talk about our history and what has occurred to us and what we've been forced to endure, and do so with accuracy. And I think that it's racist to describe that quote unquote great migration as blacks leaving the South. Maybe I missed it. Someone can correct me if I am wrong. Where on earth did he get the information that the husband left her? He said that he could find where she got married, but then he must have left her when at some point, and she was left with a 2-year-old. And I was like, that, okay, if I am incorrect, then I will stand corrected. But if he just pulled that out of nowhere, what? That doesn't make any sense. That's not scholarly. And I think that just plays into this whole negative image and negative stereotype that, you know, black men just refuse to stay with black women, or we can't have a black family unit. And then in that entire clip, like, the way he's talking about it, it's so striking to me that white people do not feel bad whatsoever about the enslavement of black people, like, at all. It's not in them at all. They'll just be like, yeah, it was tragic, but, you know, so I saw this pillow and I decided, like, there's no remorse whatsoever. I'm also currently listening to that Malcolm X book, and he says that each white person, when looking in the face of a black person, should fall to their knees and beg for forgiveness. They're not even close to thinking about that. You know, they completely get off on this. And, I mean, you can just hear it in their tone. Like, I'm sure he's smiling and all of that. Like, they don't feel bad whatsoever. And then there was an allusion to Jesus in the red lettering, whatever. I am the one in VA. I used to, like, Richmond was my stomping grounds. And it is a hipster haven now, and it's really sad because Richmond used to be a very thriving black community. That's just cut me off whenever I get to my 5, because I have so many notes, so I'll try to get them in. But and then Jackson Ward is gone, which was like the prominent black area in Richmond, where you have a 2 Street, it's called 2 Street as well. There's a 2 Street festival. It's completely gone, and it's nothing but hipster town, and white people are all over there, just, and it's terrible, like, especially if you go on a Saturday and you're in that Chaco Bottom. 17th Street Market is still like the big slave market. She was talking about the ones that are on the corners, but there was like a big one because it was right by the James River. So they would march us from the river over to 17th Street Market, and it's still there. It's a farmer's market now, but it's still there. Like, it hasn't been destroyed or anything like that. And they have, like, little things to commemorate the enslavement of black people, but it's whatever. If you go there on a Saturday, white people are drunk all over the place. It's scary. Listen to Gus. Don't be drunk around white people. Don't be around white people when they're drunk. I'll say this, and then if I hit my 5 minutes, that's fine, but I do want to talk about the issue with Nate Parker. I am a black female, and number one, I love Birth of a Nation. Number two, yeah, I have an issue with Nate Parker being married to a white female, but he's a victim just like me, so I'm not even going to pay attention to that. I think messages can come through whomever, and none of us are perfect or without our faults. Number three, I really, really had hoped that enough of us would have understood that, and what by that I mean his allegations of rape or whatever, it being brought to the forefront with the Birth of a Nation as a racist white ploy to keep so many of us out of the theaters and supporting this film. I'm hopeful that in the future, if it plays on USAA or BET or the DVD comes out, that more people will watch it, critique it, whatever. But it is the first, in my opinion, of its kind. And I think that, like, I mean, the message is powerful. It's black people taking up arms against white people no matter what. You know what I mean? We do know he dies, but that's historical. Like, but he does. And I think it broke my heart, especially once I saw the film, because I thought it was just very artistic. And I thought that it had I think that Nate Parker did what he could do, and I think his team did what they could do. I could, you know, we can always fault find, and I'm not going to do that with him. But to me, like, the way, and okay, so that's what I have to say about Nate Parker, but the way that that female was talking about it was very frustrating for me, because I'm so sick and tired, like, I'm exhausted, if anything, by how racism, white supremacy has been playing with my mind from day one till now, you know? And it's like, it's so subtle. It's like, it's gaslighting all the time, making you feel crazy and confused all the time. She didn't want to just say it. And it took her forever, because I wrote a note, like, why are we not talking about racism here? And then she goes to say, oh, well, everyone was talking about racism, but it's not racism. It's privilege. And it's all the other, like, no, like, that's like, stop. Stop right there. Stop playing with my mind. Stop trying to play with my mind. It's racism. And so, like, this is the problem with people who have degrees and people who think that they're so smart, is, like, the problem with them, and then also the problem, like, not the problem with those of us who fall prey to that, but this whole dynamic of he who has gone to school or has some education in $10 words or whatever, they trick us, and because they come off as so powerful, we're listening, and the truth is you ain't saying nothing, and you're really just lying the whole time. The reason that Casey Affleck didn't catch any flack for, you know, whatever his racist things or whatever, is because he's white. And the reason that is because it's racism, point blank, period. It's simple. It's not privilege. It's not, there's nothing else in there to keep him from having it and Nate Parker from not catching it, I don't know if that's a metaphor, but the whole point was racism. She skated around it. She pussyfooted it. She confused it. And she wanted to say a whole bunch of nonsense. But point blank and period, the reason that, and, you know, like, a lot of self-hate on us, like, within us non-white people, self-hating and attacking Nate Parker and, you know, all of that we have going on, but then also the white folks, too. So, thank you.
Right on. Other folks who dialed in that we have not heard from at all, if you had commentary.
Have you heard?
Yes, sir.
Good evening, Gus. Good evening to all the callers. I must say, echo what everyone else said. The show was great. Thank you for having it. It's a great platform to exchange views on the system. The number one problem on the planet, the only problem that we need to solve that will solve all the rest of the problems. And it's been a tumultuous year. Oh, man, I had 8 pages for review, but I'm on the plantation, so I can't go through them. However, I did want to say, you know, this Trump thing this year was really what made this year so great. If you're studying racism, this was a great year to do some studies. My resolution last year was to simplify my definition and conform it and see how it worked. And I think that I did that by January 2nd. I was done with it. So I was very happy with that. I got a 2-word definition for the system. And I've yet to see anyone go against those 2 words. I just wanted to make some comments. I wasn't able to hear the clips. However, I suppose you did the year in review clips.
No, we did not.
Man, oh, you did? Oh, good.
We did
good,
the week in review. This was just the week in review.
When's the year in review if you're doing one?
I talked about that earlier. I said, basically, I don't know, or I would prefer not to do it, but enough people like yourself were like, oh man, what happened to the interview program? Where's that at? And, such. So, I will have to reconsider, to just maybe do it right at the beginning of, January.
Absolutely, man. We had a lot of, great losses this year. Some great people. Of course, Dr. Welsing, Dr. Sabi, Dr. Delbert Blair, Gwen Ifill. We also lost Kim Thompson, Muhammad Ali, Phife from A Tribe Called Quest, very conscious rap group, and their last album that they just put out, very good. We lost a lot of people.
Radio Raheem,
yes, man, you know. Love, hate. Maybe want to go get some 4-finger rings, Gus.
go back to the 80s. But, yeah, we lost some legends this year. And I'm glad to say they did, too. I was hoping that the Queen folk before the year ended, but we still got a few minutes. I know they say she's on her deathbed. And that's so ironic because last year she said this will be the last Christmas. I guess she meant her last Christmas. Man, it's just been a really, you know, like I said, great year to do some sit back and observe. And I some of the callers, from what they called in with, I see that everyone's making very good observations. You know, I'm just very, very happy that this show exists because we wouldn't have been able to in any other way. I just wanted to say that as this year comes forward, of course, they're always on their job. So we've had the war on drugs, which was a war on black people, and the war on terrorism, which so far has been a war on brown people, but I'm still thinking that they're going to hit us with the urban terrorists. They had the war on police this year, and next year I can see what they're pushing forward now is this cyber war. I don't know quite how that's going to, how they could implement us in it, but I could definitely see us being affected by it as they're promoting this cyber terrorism, I guess you could say. So that was very interesting. I did some research because I read an article. Well, I sent you an article, and it was so astounding. And I was like, wow, it said that there was 3,149 counties in the United States. And according to the article, they said that Hillary won only 57 of them. So I did some research. I was like, that can't be right. And I did the math. And what I found out, that I went through each state, counted the counties, counted the delegates. Out of the 3,149 counties inside the United States, Trump won 2,626. Hillary won 487. So I don't see how someone could cheat an election and they won that many counties. I mean, that's pretty much, man, that's blatant. I mean, and it just shows you how little bit of space we occupy as black people here in the United States. We're only in a few places in abundance, and we're spread out everywhere else. So it just shows just how many white people are here. But I'll mute my line. Great year in review. Great. I hope you do that show because I would love to participate. Also, you know, another great loss this year, one for our team, I guess you could say, was we lost Anthony Scalia. And ironically, a week after he was implicated in some child sex pornography and molestation case, he croaks. So I was very happy to see him go. Nancy Reagan, I was happy to see her go. Her husband's war on the Black Panthers and then the war on drugs that he implemented on our people. I was very glad to see her go. I'll mute my line. Thank you, Gus.
Just say no. Other folks that we have not heard from at all, if you have not spoken at all, and Radio Raheem is the great, late great Bill Nunn. He was obviously in Do the Right Thing, but he was also in New Jack City. He was in Glory. He has a pretty impressive body of work if you go back and check out some of the other projects he was involved in. But yeah, the great Bill Nunn, who also died much too early. Tends to happen. 63. What a disgrace. Actually, he died at the age of 62. He hadn't even had his birthday for this year yet, so 62. Anyone we have not heard from, you should speak now.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Can I be heard?
I heard both of you. We'll get our caller in Florida first.
All right. Thank you, sir. Greetings to Gus, the host, the listeners, and callers. I had a few observations since it's still around the so-called holiday time that I was spending with my attempted family members. There was one interesting thing that happened where my young niece, she was reading a book. I think it's the the character is Corduroy the Bear, and it had like black characters in the book. So like my auntie, she had said, "Oh, they have black people in the book. Wow!" And you know, my sister was like, "No, don't say that." And you know, they're quote unquote regular people. And you know, I was just observing, and that was interesting. She used the word regular, and my brother, he started saying about like how on his baby picture that he was light skinned, you see, and he was saying, "Man, you know, I used to have lighter skin and this and that," saying that to his girlfriend, and you know, now I look like this, so you know, whatever that's supposed to mean. And his girlfriend was saying, he's black now, he's melanated. And we all went outside on the balcony to take a picture with each other, and my cousin, he was saying, "Oh, you need to turn that flash on, you know, because all you're going to see is teeth," and everybody started laughing. So a lot of, I think that term anti-blackness is very accurate, even during the time where we're supposed to be, enjoying each other's company. But, I expect the toxicity to be very high, pretty much. But I wanted to also comment on the audio segments. I don't know if his name was Paladino or something, like when he, I think that was him making that statement about, it sounded like he used two animal metaphors, like the mad cow disease, and saying that the first lady should be released in Africa, as though he's talking about an animal. So he was saying, you know, it needed to be said. I think that was him saying that it needed to be said. And sometimes, you know, you got to add some humor onto it. So that was interesting that he said that. And the lady that was talking about privilege, and she, like, the way that she made that statement about, you know, it's not just white privilege. It's about privilege and having power in Hollywood. But she didn't really provide any examples where this discussion doesn't involve race. So, you know, that was even more confusing. And that's all I can pretty much think about for now. But I also wanted to point out, I've heard a term called undercover racist by some non-whites a couple of times. And I thought logically that term don't really make any sense to me. Because once you start to think that a white supremacist is a racist, you know, they're not considered undercover anymore. So I guess that could also be a metaphor, but that's the language I've been hearing too. So I'll pass it on to the next person, and I greatly appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. That is a metaphor, in my opinion, undercover racist, whatever. That almost makes me think it's something worthy of a cowbell. That was Carl Paladino, I think that's how you say his name. This is the suspected race soldier who is a Trump supporter and said that Michelle Obama, he said she was a man, which stood out because Pumpkin, one of our longtime listeners, she had been, I think she was, this was on Facebook, we were talking, and she said that I have a collection of white people, racists, calling Michelle Obama a man. And I said, I can like easily, you know, think of her being compared to a monkey or a gorilla or some sort of ant, like tons of those. I pull that up, no problem. Or calling her a nigger or talking about her posterior and just all sorts of stuff. I said, I don't know if I have, I might be stumped. Like I might have to go do some digging to come up with lots of examples of her being referred to as a man. And she said, oh yeah, it's been rife, tons of it. And then bam, I was like, oh, there we go. There's one, like I can start that now. So I'll have that. But I also, this one stood out because this was another example. And I think the caller in Florida, I think we had talked about this before, where you get these racists, they do something flagrantly racist. Like everybody has to come and say, oh yeah, that was
definitely racist, but we can't really do anything to them. We can't, it's just somehow we can't do anything to get them out of their position. Like, that happens all the time. And in that segment, they had a black female come out and she gave the whole list. Like, we are impotent as hell. We can't do anything. We can't censor him. We can't fire him. We can't reprimand him. Like, we can't do nothing. Wish him a happy 2017. That's about, I was like, yep, that is about what I would expect in the system of white supremacy. And then to get a victim to come out and tell how weak and impotent we are. And he's with the school board. I almost started that with, why aren't we learning anything? Maybe that's why. Maybe it's not that black people are dumb and ignorant. Maybe we just have lots of race soldiers who are running the school system where it is designed to niggerize black people. Anybody we have not heard from at all, you should speak now.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
I would say greetings to the Cal family. Greetings to you, Gus. Thank you for the program. I sat back this year. I learned from everybody, on all the listeners. 1842, very proud of you. I sat back and listened to your growth with the white people, white men, old white men touching you. And you standing up. Ross Thomas up in New York, hold it down. Respect y'all hustle. Keep it on the move. Miami, Florida, retired firefighter. Down there in Florida. Stay up. Congratulations on your win. North Dakota, my southern brother, come on back to the South. Be careful up there with all those white folks. And rest in peace to Dr. Ms. Welsing, Dr. Welsing. And I know there's a lot of some of the brothers that came on the Cows claiming that they listened to the Cows and they listened to Dr. Francis Cress Welsing and Neely Fuller, but you, I don't know, these brothers, I look at their actions and they doing the opposite, you know, they calling each other names and this and that. I'm not going to call them out, call them by their name, but I think everybody know. Yeah, the Cow's been real helpful to me, and I hope we have a good year this year. Thank you.
Ashe. Ashe. Did we miss anybody? Anybody we haven't heard from at all? Splendid. We got everybody. So we have 10 minutes left. And just for listeners, I guess for the people on the East Coast, Florida, New York, D.C., Virginia, South Carolina, New England, Massachusetts, Connecticut, all that. The folks out there, Michigan, it is about to be 2017. I'm on the West Coast, so it's not even 9 p.m. here. So, you know, I don't celebrate that stuff anyway, but I mean, it's still hours before all of that. So I am not ducking or doing anything. That's why I'm just hanging out. And I have nothing to say about all that other than the folks on the East Coast are about to, I guess, get ready to duck, retired firefighter, and anybody else. I did want to get in. I did play in the segment where it talked about Steve Sampson, the white EMT worker. That's another one. This is who you're calling if you need EMT to come and give you medical assistance. This guy makes up this lie about black thugs came and looted his Christmas gifts. And I played this I'm a liar in between there. Dear friend of mine, black female nurse on top of it. She loved that song. Just thought it was the funniest thing, and that's who I connect to that song. But when I heard that immediately came to mind, like, yep, that is the truth, that is whites, and it is fitting that a white person would make a song like that, and it would become a big hit, and just white people love that song. It's kind of an oldie. I think it came out in like the 90s, but became a big hit. But that should be exactly what we have in mind when we think of white people. Anybody else have commentary they wanted to get in? Last 10 minutes.
May I add something?
Yes, ma'am.
In Texas, I found out that you can do a recall election on every elected official except the school board members.
Why did you, or yeah, did they explain why the school board is so special that you can't do a recall on them?
No, they didn't. They just said that, you know, it's not allowed. The only way you can get rid of a school board member is to have someone at the state level process their resignation or get rid of them. But you can't just do a recall election after they get elected.
Wow.
They love being in charge of our children.
That is hugely important. That's Mr. Palladino. He's a part of the Buffalo School Board where they absolutely can do nothing to him, even after his commentary about the Obamas, racist white supremacist commentary about the Obamas.
W, finally, Mr. Trump spoke out against the guy up there, the Buffalo School Board. I think he ran for the governor against Cuomo, if I'm not mistaken. However, I do want to make one last comment because I was watching CNN this morning when I got off of work, and they put out a number which was very astounding, which was astonishing, actually. 82 shootings a week in Chicago. I don't know who's doing the shootings. I've heard, you know, a lot of people, even on the show tonight, say that, you know, there's a lot of sketchiness about who's committing the shootings, but it's no doubt who's getting shot. And that's something we definitely need to fix ASAP, especially working in the hospital here tonight. And, I've already heard two traumas come in, and I just could assume that they might be gunshots. So I just want to say, you know, we need to fix that. If we're going to shoot someone, let's shoot each other, and I'll meet my mom.
Can I be heard? Hello?
Yes, I hear you.
Oh, okay, thank you. I just wanted to say, yeah, I know people in Chicago, too, and I've been told, and I believe it was Pam who also discussed the fact that she believes that that it's police that are doing the shootings. I believe that as well. That's something I've heard from people I know in the Chicago area. I just wanted to say my new year, actually, I followed a comedic calendar. And the new year for me starts September 11th of every year. But for those who follow this next upcoming 365 or 64 and a quarter, I wish everyone to be as safe as possible. I wish us as much progress against the system of white supremacy. Hopefully we can end it in the next 365. I wish everyone to just stay safe, continue to spread the word to as many people that will listen as possible in regards to us fighting this problem. It is the only problem, as Thomas in New York said earlier, peace to you too. It's the only problem, and from that problem, all of our other problems are basically generated. So I'm hoping that we can make as much progress as possible. Rest in peace to Dr. Welsing. Rest in peace to Dr. Ben. Rest in peace to Dr. Clark. Rest in peace to Maurice White. All of the other people that we lost this year and that we've lost previously, and may you all continue to help us fight from the world of the dead to replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Thank you, Gus, for all that you've done. Your work is definitely some of the most important work I've come across. I thank you so much, and to all the other callers as well. Your comments, your input has also helped to change my life and my perspective in many ways, and facilitates the work that I do to help replace the system of white supremacy with justice as well. And I thank you all for being who you are. May the ancestors guide and protect you always.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
And just to verify, I'm in the Chicago area. 70% of the murders here are unsolved. So there's something going on here, and it ain't just black-on-black violence. So I can verify that.
Can I be heard?
Oh, yes, sir. We can hear you.
Okay. Just to tag on to that, I read an article earlier this year, and I think I reported it on a previous broadcast, that the police, or rather law enforcement officials, have reported to various media sources that they have technology that basically predicts individuals as who are going to be victims of crimes. I thought that that was going to, I thought that that was very interesting. They were people who they predicted that were going to be involved in or victims of gun violence. And this was done by algorithm. And if they can predict individuals that they say are going to be on that list, I think that they are, they could be perhaps selecting targets, rather. I think that might be the situation. So if anybody can, you know, do some research on algorithms and the and predicting crime, you will find some very interesting information regarding that. And also, speaking of Chicago, a Chicago comedian by the name of Mikey Manker, and I think he might be, as a result of this article that was published about him, might be just straight-up suspected race soldier. He was in a conversation earlier this week speaking with other suspected racist comedians in Chicago, and they were discussing how to victimize non-white victims of white supremacy. And one of the things that they said that he indicated was a great way of victimizing victims of racism is to ask them what their definition of racism is. And he says that most of them will not have a definition. So I've taken it upon myself to spread that infographic or that cover that's being used for Mr. H. Fox, Honorific Fox's archive of the Context of White Supremacy. It has that real simplified definition that basically says that racism is the people who identify themselves as white, who are dedicated to mistreating and subjugating those who they classify as non-white. I think that that is one of the most salient, clear definitions of racism. It basically neutralizes their ability to use the term racism against us. And if you keep repeating that ad nauseum, using that definition, saying that definition ad nauseum, that is one way that I've seen that effectively neutralizes their ability to confuse other victims. So I just wanted to give that little tidbit about a racist suspect, race soldier, comedian, Mikey Manker in Chicago, Illinois. Thank you so much. I will mute my line.
Right on. I guess 2017, for so I've been told, for the people in Eastern time, and for our folks that listen on the continent of the UK, it's already 2017. It's been that way for a while for them, so right on. I did want to say really quickly before I check if 1842 is satisfied as well. Number one, one of our listeners in the Missouri area, he posted, I played that report about the Little League facility that was vandalized. They didn't mention all of the swastikas and flagrant racist items that were written in graffiti all over this facility. They omitted that. But there was a report today where they found some of the young white hoodlums who did this. And of course, they wrote pictures of penises as well. So you got penises, swastikas, nigger, I mean, man, Dr. Francis Cress Welsing again. But in the article, suspected Henrico Vandal's mother says, of course, what's the drum roll? My son isn't racist. And she says he did admit to breaking the sink and drawing pictures of genitalia, explained his mother. But he did not write racist words or none of that. His girlfriend is actually black, so he's far from being racist. Had to get that in before 2016 is completely gone for all of us. There was one other comment I wanted to get in. Oh yeah, the listener that mentioned Jack Johnson, lots of cowbells will be all over the place. Jack Johnson getting a pardon written at the Undefeated. My understanding, The Undefeated is associated with ESPN, and I don't consume ESPN content. Like, I don't watch any of their shows, and I don't read The Undefeated, and I do this deliberately because I, Dr. Boyce Watkins, black male, he's a writer, he has content on YouTube, talks about racism frequently. He did a segment that I thought was really, really just outstanding work. I played it as a part of the Compensatory Call-In some years back, where he was talking about ESPN and basically saying that he thought they were doing programming geared towards black males specifically, that they know there are a lot of particularly younger black males or black males, period, who are interested in sports. You got a lot of black males who are unemployed, so they have a lot of time to watch television. This is, I'm paraphrasing, but these are some of the points he was making. So they're really trying to get that black male demographic, hook them in and get them to watch this content. And so you have programs like what you mentioned, sports shows with one white person, one black person. They fight, go back and forth. Maybe they'll mention race. I thought the same thing. I thought this was being staged, though, for that sort of purpose, just racial theater, basically. So I don't watch any of that content. I think I played the final time I saw Stephen A. Smith talk about anything years back, 2012, when he talked about Jeremy Lin. Classic. We reviewed that whole piece. You can go back. If you're ever feeling bad or if you need a laugh, go find that segment from ESPN First Take with Stephen A. Smith, Skip Bayless, where they talk about racism and Jeremy Lin from 2012, when all the racism was being focused on Jeremy Lin when he was with the Knicks. But that being said, 1842, did you have anything you were going to add?
Can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am. Too slow on your mute button.
I am. It's like the phone locks up and then I got to open it and get to the, anyway, I got to figure that out so I can be quick with it like everyone else. But I won't mention anything about the notes or the clips or anything like that. But just some possible suggestions, things that I've been doing to kind of be prepared for, you know, the new year or what's to come next. Just sitting and thinking about what things are going to be important in the upcoming year, like setting SMART goals. That was something I think someone had mentioned it like a long time ago in a workplace. But if you, I won't go through it because I know we're at our time, but if you just Google SMART goals so that they're specific and measurable, attainable, and all that kind of stuff, and like write it down just so that you can, we can all, this is something that I do and something I'm doing as we speak. So I'm not saying anything from any kind of other space, but that way we can reach goals and we can make measurable steps and hold ourselves accountable. So just some things, you know, like even words that might be important to you, or like I know Gus has a prayer at the end of every show, but maybe thinking of one that's really personalized to you, just so that 2017 can be better personally, if not, you know, globally for all of us, we can make it a better year for ourselves personally. And with that, I'm clear and complete. Thank you.
Grand. Particularly, really, this should be code for every weekend. That's the thing. When you develop a code, then special occasions are no problem because you just stick to the code. But for people this weekend, sobriety, I would definitely encourage all the way through. You already know they're going to have the checkpoints out on what have you. We already have enough problems with race soldiers, with the Daniel Holtz Claws and Darren Wilsons of the universe. We do not need to make their job any easier by being under the influence on this here weekend. If you got to consume anything, tobacco, cannabis, alcohol, whatever else, get to one spot and stay there. That way you don't have to run the risk of having to explain or be in contact with a race soldier, badge or no. White people are extremely dangerous. We need to keep that in the forefront of our mind at all times. With that, just check Black Talk Radio Network, the Facebook page. You'll see all the dates for the programs for the upcoming week, first week in January. If you get confused, have a problem, the email again, untiljustice@gmail.com. And again, for folks who are interested in Mr. Ken Steele, his offer, if you have some tech experience, you can go back. I think it was Workplace Racism this week on Thursday where he explained the details. You can just drop me your resume, your information, and I will forward it along to Mr. Steele. The folks who already sent me their information, it has already been done. Thanks again for everyone who tuned in. I hope it was a constructive investment of your Saturday evening. We will be extremely focused and serious for 2017. The problem remains white people. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Context of White Supremacy signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, your brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.